I don't like it, but it seems to be the way it's going to be every time now. Perhaps every single week, every show we do, we'll have celebrity deaths to report on.
I don't like it either.
It's not great.
No.
It's frustrating. And we talked about it before. The reason that it is the way it is that I think there's just more famous people than there's ever been.
I think that's certainly true.
Like 100 years ago around this time, it's like, oh, whoa. So did you hear about the Archduke Ferdinand? Whoa, crazy.
Right.
We can nibble on that for a few months.
Right.
And now it's just like every single week there's going to be somebody or something.
Yes.
And so we depressingly report that that John Hurd died. Not a name that I think everybody would know off the top of their head, but would certainly recognize him if you saw him. He's kind of one of those guys. And
he was the dad in Home Alone.
Yeah, well, of course, he was. That's the thing that I think people would remember him for. But we would know him for other fare, such as Cat People.
Yes.
Which, so long ago, we talked about that on the show. It's stuck in your mind, right?
Yeah, it's a weird one.
It's a weird one.
It's just totally
Grinch.
Weird.
Yeah, but it's awesome, though. And sadly, probably won't talk about it anytime soon, because 65%...
Yeah.
Means you're safe from our Rotten Tomatoes segment.
Which is odd that it's 65%.
It's odd that I called it a Rotten Tomatoes segment because we've proudly branded it the Craft Disservices segment.
That's right.
In which we review a film that is below 50% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll be doing that today, of course.
Yep.
As we continue our... I'll introduce us in a second. We're just getting right into this because we don't have a lot of time. Where we continue our second week of Theron Back Again.
That's right.
Where we look at the work of Charlize Theron. We're talking about Aeon Flux. This week, 10% on Rotten Tomatoes.
Yep.
Not great. So this is definitely one of those films that critics rejected, and actually audiences pretty roundedly rejected it as well. But we'll talk about what's really wrong with it. All leading up, of course, to our review next week of Atomic Blonde after its release.
Yes.
Which is looking to be all right.
Yeah.
We'll see. I mean, we don't really know.
No, we don't.
And we talked about last week, of course, The Coldest City, the graphic novel, which Atomic Blonde is loosely based on.
Yeah.
For our comic book club segment, comics and movies, wow, that sounds like the Just Enough Trope podcast.
It does.
I'm your host, Caliban, joined as always by my co-host.
Hi, I'm Mikan Hanna.
And we're still talking about these sad celebrity deaths. He was also, I don't know if you remember this, I know you've seen the first couple seasons of The Sopranos. He was the crooked cop on The Sopranos.
Oh.
Every once in a while, Tony would go and talk to that guy. And, you know, John Hurd is a good-looking guy, solid-looking guy.
Yeah.
But I always thought he was nominated for an Emmy for his work on The Sopranos, and I always thought he just looked real, like, sweaty. He just looked like he embodied that role. He looked like the kind of guy who would be a dirty cop, you know,
okay.
Who's like, yeah, you know, he's a real wise guy, but he's also kind of like... got a little nose problem or something that he's feeding, you know, or I think he had a couple ex-wives. So it's that sort of was a good guy once, but has definitely hit bottom.
Straight and off the beaten path.
Yeah, he's given Tony whatever he wants.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was great. I wanted to mention, too, that Deborah Watling died. She played Victoria on Doctor Who.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, and it's funny because... she was a second doctor companion, mostly. And she was one of these actresses who, along with, now I'm going to guess, because we're getting back into Whodum here. Whodum.
Whodum.
New actress, Whodum this. Like Sarah Kingdom, I think. And then what was it like? Polly? There's a stretch of companions where we just don't have almost anything for them. Because these are the lost, destroyed episodes.
Right.
And it wasn't until that big find in, like, 2013 that we got, like, most of her episodes back.
Okay.
Like, we're up to, like, 60% of, like, what she taped is extant now.
Okay.
And who knows? You know, we heard the weird story a couple of years ago at CONvergence about how they'll find these tapes in, like, a BBC affiliate station, on Pitcairn Island or something like that.
Right.
Then suddenly somebody goes, oh, wait a minute. Here's a bunch of Doctor Who shows.
Right.
Along with Bullseye or, I don't know, some other obscure British show.
Right.
And so they bring those things in. And so, yeah, just really nice, very pretty woman who played the kind of companion that I feel like they should do more of these days, where she was from the past. She was like a Victorian woman.
Okay.
So he picks her up. And then shows her the future, which for her is anything past 1863.
That's a lot.
Or whatever, yeah.
Yeah.
And it isn't just, oh, it was bigger on the inside than it is on the outside. And it's like, all right, you're from modern London and got the estuary accent and all that sort of thing. It's a little different. So, yeah. And then, of course, she was on with Jamie as well. They were kind of co-companions. And so, yeah, nice lady. I'm trying to think if she did. I'm not sure she did a whole bunch after that. But.
Okay.
And, of course, you probably heard that Chester Bennington died, who was the lead singer of Linkin Park.
Yes, I heard about that.
Yeah.
It's tragic, another suicide in the world of music.
Yeah, I mean, I was never a big Linkin Park fan, but for people that I know who were...
Oh, I was.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Maybe you should take the lead on this. Actually, just answer this question for me. I heard that, like a, I don't know, Green Day, par example, you know, they kind of started off doing one thing, but as the musicians aged, they sort of matured and... started doing a lot of things. Uh-huh. It wasn't just like with Green Day, like three chord songs about jerking off. Like, you know, they started to get political and they started to do orchestral stuff. And, you know, Linkin Park kind of did the same thing.
I think so, for sure. It's a shame, too. Like, I saw a video of him talking about his depression.
Oh, yeah.
And he was, you know, really struggling with it.
And he was, I mean, so it's extra sad, but he was good friends with Chris Cornell.
Yeah.
And I think Chris Cornell's passing hit him really hard. And so,
yeah,
it's all terribly bad.
It is terrible.
And not really great. Yeah. And so they're just people that will be missed. And I think that if we're going to keep doing this, and as we said at the beginning of the show, we're going to have to, because it's not going to stop. We should turn this into, instead of, you know, a death of celebrities, it should be a celebration of their talents.
There you go.
And so when something like this happens, like it's probably going to, we should definitely, you know, talk about the great things that they did.
I agree.
Like tying Natasha Kinski to a bed and having sex with her until she turned into a panther and then locking her in a zoo. That is a weird movie.
It's a weird
movie. Weird movie. Yeah.
It's a weird movie.
Don't know about the sexual politics of that. A little weird. No. Anyway, not his fault. Great actor. Let's get into what we're talking about. We mentioned CONvergence recently, minutes ago, and we're excited to present a couple of the interviews that we did with some of the great guests at CONvergence, which we'll be doing throughout the month. We had so many of these, and I was wondering how we're going to get them out to the people.
Yes.
I thought the best thing to do would be to try to pair them, like a sommelier would suggest, a little pairing of this with this. And so today we'll be talking about on the show the movie Aeon Flux.
Mm-hmm.
In concert with that, I wanted to talk about the TV show and its inspirations as well.
Sure.
Kind of a stretch. Not really a stretch, but it's kind of cyberpunky, right? There are cyberpunk influences in Aeon Flux, no question. And so I thought we could talk to Lyda Morehouse.
Okay.
Who has written cyberpunk fiction.
Sure.
And we talk about that in her interview, along with Naomi Kritzer, guest of honor at CONvergence as well. We did a twofer.
Yes, we did.
On that one, and had a great talk with them. I also wanted to interject our interview with Emma Bull.
Okay.
Who we talk with every year.
Yes.
At CONvergence. And it was wonderful to talk to her as usual. Not really, I'm not sure there's anything that is strictly cyberpunk in her. You got it.
Yeah.
And use Google Translate on that. And but maybe something like Bone Dance.
Okay.
Or one or two of her other novels have something kind of dystopiesque things that could possibly be considered punky or cyberpunky. This whole show is going to be cyberpunky. That's where Punky has an implant in her head for Microsoft's, where she can learn to talk to Brandon, jack into the cyber nodes. So that's who we're talking to. Also, all three of those authors are women and write strong female characters,
or
just good characters that are female.
Yes.
And because we're working with Aeon Flux today, I thought that would be a good idea. Good connection.
Yes.
So we'll do that. We've got a little bit of news, but we're really going to have to blow through that because the big news is, of course, San Diego Comic-Con was this weekend. And our last show was called Fake Trailers because of all the things that people put on YouTube, like, check this out. I got you. Not a real trailer.
Right.
It's that guy, Rick, dancing.
Rick Astley.
Yeah. But instead, we've got a bunch of real, actual trailers that came from the con that we're going to talk about that is pretty much going to set your table for the next 9 months or so in terms of what you're looking for out of your genre entertainment.
Yeah.
Is that it? That's enough.
We have a review of Valerian as well.
How many planets were there?
There are like 12,000. I don't know.
You're a Minnesotan. You're doing the Minnesotan thing. It's the land of 10,000 lakes. Actually, it's the land of 13,163 lakes. No, it's the city of 1,000 planets.
Oh, okay. That's
which
right.
We saw, and I don't want to spoil my review, but there's like 200. Like 300 planets tops in that thing. So later on in the show, we'll have our review of that. And a sneak preview of next week's show, getting our Valerians and our Aeons and our Therons all sort of mixed up.
Yes.
We are going to actually have a review of the first Valerian graphic novel series, or trade paperback, on our next show.
Because
it's a comic book, don't you know?
Yes.
And we'll be talking about that then. Whew! How are you? Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you strapped in?
I'm ready to rumble.
How's your week been?
It's been crazy.
Still sort of recovering from Convergence, I can imagine.
Yes, and also recovering from Rock the Garden.
Ooh.
Yeah.
10-word review of that. We don't have the time.
It's a festival here in Minneapolis put on by The Walker. And
that's pretty much that's it.
The Walker and The Current. So
okay,
yeah,
that's fine. Yeah, what acts were there?
The Revolution and Bon Iver were what we went to see.
Oh, okay.
But
there's different
also,
stages.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's also Car Seat Headrest, Benjamin Booker.
huge names.
Yeah, Dead Man Weather was there.
Dead Man Weather.
Uh huh.
How does Jack White feel about that?
I don't know.
Okay. Isn't he like, what? I've got a band called Dead Weather. I've got a label called Third Man. So I don't know what if third Dead Man Weather guy is gonna make it out of here.
I don't know. We'll have a kung fu fight. We'll see.
Jack, can you see Jack White having a kung fu fight? Jack White isn't a kung fuer. He's the guy who's in charge of the evil kung fuers. Bruce Lee meets at the end of the movie, like in a mirror maze or something like that. He goes, oh, I see you've made it to me. And he takes his fedora off, you know, and he's got like a cyber brain underneath or something like that. I'm trying to get us back into our cyberpunkies here. And then he's got to fight Bruce Lee. Speaking of Bruce Lee, what was it? The Rise of the Dragon or the Start of the Dragon? The Dragon Gets Some Coffee?
It's something like that.
We saw that a preview for that film, which is supposed to be the sort of early days of Bruce Lee. The Birth of the Dragon.
Yes.
Where he fights this other guy. This is great. It's Wong Jack Man. It's supposedly like a true story of how they tested their styles against each other.
Yes.
Every time, first of all, we're seeing this with the Han Solo movie guide, where it's like, we want you to play an iconic character, but also an iconic actor.
Right.
Do Harrison Ford, go. Easy now. That's it. That's how he does it now. Yeah, I don't really care. They interviewed him. Like, so if you had to think of like an opposite number for Harrison Ford, like Harrison Ford represents something on a scale of personality or humanity.
He's,
you know, there's ITFP or whatever. He's like, F you, leave me alone. Those are his like letters. What's the opposite? Chris Hardwick.
Sure.
Chris Hardwick is like the anti-Ford. Like they are literally, even though he idolizes Harrison Ford, they could not be more different.
Yes.
And so every year Harrison Ford has to go for some movie to Hall H and have Chris Hardwick lob questions at him enthusiastically but guardedly, because he is a nerd and Harrison Ford would have shoved that guy in a locker so fast in high school. And he asked him about how at the Blade Runner panel, like, we're already doing our SDCC segment. We'll get into it. So, Harrison, is it your goal to remake every one of your movies? Like, is that what you're going to do? You know, Indiana Jones and this and the other thing? And he's like, you bet your ass. You bet your ass. Yeah. He also wants to remake some of his famous crashes, too. He's going to try to get back to that golf course, but with a newer, sort of fresher plane and maybe a new complication. Let's do it. Let's talk about news. There's so much news from San Diego Comic-Con. San Diegoites.
Sure.
Every year have to deal with the con. And we do. We know a couple people from San Diego. And we go, boy, I'd love to get to that con. And they're like, take your time. Take your time. You don't have to come. Don't drive. You'll never make it.
Right.
It's impossible to drive. Every year we're just assaulted by people who are glad. We're glad they come.
Right.
And I wonder, I've never been. I'd love to go someday. I used to go to the con in Chicago a lot, and I know that every time I went there, I was grabbed the Sunday paper when I was there. And they always have this story about how, like, look, nerds are taking over downtown. Look out, everybody.
Right.
If you see somebody with some claws, don't worry. It's just a friendly Wolverine cosplayer. You may remember him from such films as Australia and Real Steel, but it's fine. And so I'm sure they go through the same thing. We're going to go through a couple news things really fast. I want to talk about the fact that Sony, their Robotech cartoon show. Remember Robotech?
Sure.
Tell me about Robotech.
I don't remember that much about it.
But you remember it, though.
I remember it's a thing.
It's one of the earliest animes.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a Japanese anime that was imported here by a company called Harmony Gold. And
don't they, like, turn into a giant robot?
Well, it's an anime.
Yeah.
You nailed it right there. And what's interesting about it is when they translated it, they didn't really worry a lot about what the actual translation of a lot of the dialogue was or the storyline. They just re-recorded the English dialogue, and then they used that freedom to craft a new story.
Okay.
So they took it in new directions. And actually, the entire Robotech saga has three... We're wasting time. I apologize. I'll get through this real fast. Has three different sort of eras.
Okay.
And they're three different animes, basically, that this company just bought and went, all right, this blue-haired chick, we'll just say that she's the daughter of so-and-so, and this is 25 years later.
Okay.
And then whatever the original actors were saying, forget that. Now it's blah, 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 Robotech, blah, 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 Invid, blah, 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 whatever. And so they created, like, this whole overarching thing out of three shows that had, like, really nothing to do with it, with each other. But like you said, transforming robots.
There we go.
Makes it easy. There's your point of connection. Yeah. Well, the guy who's directing the It reboot, Andy Muschietti, is going to direct Sony's Robotech film.
Okay.
So, we're just blasting through. Like we said, that's a little bit for you.
Is that going to be animated or live action?
Well, you got me there.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. I assume it's going to be live action. That's a little bit of homework that you could do on your own. Ant-Man and the Wasp, the sequel to Ant-Man, is expected to be produced sometime here. It's going to star, of course, Paul Rudd, and Evangeline Lilly is returning, and I'm sure Michael Douglas is also returning. But it's been announced that Walter Goggins will be joining the cast.
Okay.
Walter Goggins is, who's that?
I don't know. Who is that?
Yeah, you do.
I know the name.
He was in Hateful Eight. He's in The Shield. He's in Justified.
Oh, that guy.
Yeah, that guy. Hey, he's really good.
Yeah.
Him and his teeth are excellent, excellent actors. And probably bigger than that, should have started with this. It's been announced that Michelle Pfeiffer will be in the film as the original Wasp, Janet Van Dyne.
All right.
Mother to Hope Van Dyne.
That's exciting. I'm glad to see that Michelle Pfeiffer is doing some work.
Yeah. I don't know where she's been.
I don't know where she's been either.
I'm trying to think of... Stardust must have been almost 10 years ago now.
Yeah,
and I'm sure she's
ago.
Done something since then. But as far as, like, you know, genre sort of work goes, yeah, I think that that's good. Something that, you know, that I've always liked about her in her roles is that there's an edge to her.
Uh-huh.
And you don't think about that for Janet Van Dyne. Like, the Wasp is pretty much just a fun, happy-go-lucky, kind of guileless character.
Sure.
Usually, I mean, in the comic books. But to have her come in, you know, she's older now. And also, she, like, saved the world and got stuck in the microverse or something. So she'll be able to come back, maybe have an edge on with that. Maybe at the time that she disappeared, like, she and Hank weren't doing very well, like, in their relationship. They weren't getting along as superheroes or as man and wife, which is, of course, imported from the comic book. So, yeah, I think there's a lot of potential there. And, of course, Michael Peña will be back because, of course, everybody loves Michael Peña.
Yeah.
And he has to be in everything. Looking at other Marvel properties, it looks like Noah Hawley, the showrunner of Fargo and Legion, will be doing a Doctor Doom film.
How do we feel about this?
I have no idea.
Okay.
Because Fox, you know, is not doing Fan4Stick not good. And so they are not able to do anything with Fantastic Four. So let's take his villain and then take one of the hottest new creators, like, in Hollywood and put him on the Doctor Doom film?
Yeah, I don't know.
Too soon to do a Fantastic Four film?
Apparently.
Like, looking at Legion, it's weird. It's about, but it's also about connections and family and emotion.
Right.
Make a Fantastic Four movie.
I know.
You've got it.
Yeah.
It's in the bag.
Well, and then I don't know why I do a movie based on the villain. You know?
I know. You know, there's precedent for this because Doom has had, you know, his own. He's actually in a series right now called The Infamous Iron Man, I believe, where he's sort of being Iron Man or an Iron Man.
Okay, well, that's a different take on the character, yeah, for sure.
Absolutely. And he's, I mean, he's, I think he's one of Marvel's greatest villains, but he has had this anti-heroic streak sometimes.
Sure.
And so they'll probably explore that, like they will probably in the Venom movie, for instance.
Sure.
How do you turn Venom into a good guy? Well, first of all, you cast Mad Max, so check, box checked.
Yeah.
And then you make some guy, the bad guys are even worse than he is.
Right.
Like, up against Carnage, who is, you know, another Venom-esque villain. Anybody looks like a good guy. So, yeah. Well, more information on that as it develops. Looks like Shazam is going to start production in early 2018 of next year.
Okay.
Which is good news. Bad news is The Rock says that he will not be in it at all.
Well, what the heck?
So the first Shazam... Well, there's going to be also, speaking of villains helming their own films, there's going to be a Black Adam film.
Okay.
So... he's not going to face Black Adam in this first film, it looks like.
Well, that's disappointing.
Yeah, I wonder why. Because wouldn't you want... Here's somebody... they haven't cast anybody yet, I don't think. Here's a character that nobody really knows
right.
in this century. You put The Rock in there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Get a face that we know in yeah. there and that we care about.
Yeah. You got to Jumanji that.
Follow.
Jumanji that thing.
Yeah, exactly.
It also looks like there's going to be a Stargate digital series, a Stargate either reboot or continuation through MGM's streaming service. Everybody has a streaming okay. service now.
All right.
Including us. Check it out on patreon.com/justenoughtrope. But yeah, so there will be a Stargate revival. Stargate, your connection to the franchise. Go.
I have no connection to the franchise.
It is a zero, much like the shape of the Stargate, the titular Stargate.
Yeah.
Yeah, me too, really. Never a huge fan of the show, didn't watch a lot of it, or the follow-up shows, but I really like that James Spader movie.
Yeah.
But, like, Buffy the Vampire Slayer, of which I call myself a future fan. I haven't seen much of it yet, but I'm sure
right.
I'll love it. But I love the Joss Whedon film, so
right.
I love the movie versions of things that fail and then get turned into TV versions that everybody loves.
Right.
Which is kind of backwards.
I understand what you're saying, though.
Yeah, yeah.
I, too, love the Buffy film.
Yeah.
So.
It's good stuff.
Yeah.
Or at least Paul Reubens is a good vampire toady
yeah.
in it. It looks like Fox is, quote, reassessing, unquote, the future of the Alien franchise in the wake of Covenant.
What the heck does that mean?
I don't know. Covenant is underperforming. It's so they are possibly not going to push forward with the plans for the Covenant sequel, and they might be giving old Neil Blomkamp a call.
Oh, wow.
Because remember, nobody ever knows exactly how far they got, if the deal was closed, but he had teased a Superman Returns-esque sort of reboot of the original series, bringing back Hicks and Ripley and the whole crowd
right
to do something, and that got shut down the second that Papa Ridley came back.
Right. I mean, do we want that? I don't know that we want that.
No, we don't at all. And at this point, just stop making Alien films. We're good, right?
Yeah,
we're
I think
good.
We're good.
Yeah. Love Alien, but what are you gonna do?
I don't think we need more.
Well, the rumors are swirling as the con was getting going that Ben Affleck might not be the Batman for much longer.
Really?
Matt Reeves, the director of the upcoming film, has reported that he has, and I'm sure he said it nicer than this, but ditched the script that Ben Affleck wrote. They're going
wow.
in a whole new direction.
Okay.
And, of course, Ben Affleck stepped down from directing. Now they're not using his script. There's nothing that he's said specifically, just like memes of him looking sad, that have people guessing that maybe he kind of wants out of this thing.
Okay.
And I personally think that he does. But he reaffirmed his commitment at a panel this weekend to the thing and said it's a great effing part and he's happy to be a part of it.
Sure.
And I mean, he's an actor, so you know.
Right.
Supposedly he can act happy, but yeah, he seems like, as far as he said, he's going forward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I guess we should take the bat's word for it then.
The bat. No, we need to take the bat out. He doesn't run this town. We do. More on Justice League in a little bit, but they did show some footage from Aquaman.
Okay.
I'll describe it to you. It's basically like a sort of stormy scene, and you see this like fleet of underwater ships kind of come up, and Jason Momoa at a panel confirmed that that was Ocean Master's fleet. Ocean Master, one of the villains in the film.
Okay.
Harley Quinn versus the Joker film in development at Warner Brothers.
Okay. I thought there was going to be a Harley Quinn and
Gotham City Sirens movie.
Yeah.
You are correct.
So there's two Harley Quinn films.
All development means is, hey, wouldn't it be great? Yeah, I think so. Is there a press conference? Oh, okay. Give them that. That's all that means.
Okay.
Nothing signed. We don't know nothing about anything.
All right.
There's no writer. There's no director, but there you go.
Okay.
There was a Defenders trailer this week at SDCC that tells you more about what's coming up. We didn't watch that one.
No.
Because we're going to watch the series, but I'm sure it's just more about what's going on with them. But I do have Defenders news. At the Defenders panel at SDCC, they announced second season of Iron Fist.
Okay.
Okay.
Well.
Temper your responses. You got caught. That was one okay too many.
Okay.
You want another, what, quote, Mikan Hanna, he's a prick, end quote.
Yeah, I don't want more. That's for sure. He's kind of a doucher, so.
Yeah, well, hopefully they can clean that up a little bit. It looks like Spawn will be returning to the big screen. Todd McFarlane directing.
Okay.
No, not okay. Stop
Why
saying
do we
okay.
Why do we want him directing?
We've moved into the bad part of the news now.
Why do we want him directing?
He's never directed anything. But it is his character.
I know it's his baby, but yeah. That doesn't mean that
That's why Bob Kane
good.
Could have made the best Batman film. If only they'd let him
no,
do it.
No, not necessarily.
It doesn't sound great. It'll be produced by Blumhouse, who I think they're just drunk on their own power now. They're drunk on their own power.
Yeah.
They actually produced that Birth of the Dragon film along with WWE Films. So, all good news. Guess what? At the Outlander panel this weekend, they showed the season 3 premiere.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
The entire episode.
Lucky them.
Wow.
Would have liked to have been there.
Yeah.
You think that leaked?
I don't know. Probably.
My arm's getting tired from holding my cell phone up and stealing this whole show. Here, hold my arm up. So, of course, that's still going on, and they're up for two more seasons now. I think that's in the can. Or not, you know, in the can, but it's on the books.
In the bag.
They will be doing, two more. So that's good news. Okay. Wonder Woman 2 was officially announced at Comic-Con.
Okay.
Speaking of strong female characters.
Yeah.
Which is, of course, good news. I think they have said that this will be... I think they said that it's going to be like a 60s Cold War kind of thing.
Okay.
I could be talking out the side of my mouth or head on that, but I think that they're going to continue to try to period it.
All right.
And that, you got a character who first came out 100 years ago or whatever as
That's
a hero.
Fine.
Yeah, do it. Right. And skip World War II. Skip it. We've done it.
Yeah.
We know how that goes.
Yeah.
So that's good news. We actually talk about Wonder Woman with Emma Bull, and we'll get to that in a little bit. Speaking about DC movies, it looks like the Flash movie, which has been as hard to pin down as the Flash in recent months with their announcements, it will now be an adaptation of Flashpoint.
Okay.
The comic series from a couple years ago in DC Comics that rebooted their entire universe and has a lot of people thinking maybe DC is looking to take a mulligan on their movie universe.
You think so?
You've got... you got Ben Affleck apparently wanting to pull the bat ripcord on the bat parachute. You've got other things that are kind of in trouble and things aren't quite lined up. You've already killed and brought Superman back. More on that later. And so they're thinking maybe people, they're going to do this in order to give them a chance to make it
how
malleable.
They want it.
Yeah, right. You don't have to get rid of, say, Gal Gadot. You could keep her. But you could, why is there a new Batman? Well, time wibbly wobbly stuff.
Okay.
Yeah. Also, DC has a long tradition of multiverses, you know, in their canon. So,
sure.
You could just establish that there are other universes, and if people really like some of the, maybe just show them glimpses of things in Flashpoint, and then later on you could do the whole, you could do an Injustice movie, you could do, you know, the whole Flashpoint universe movie, you
sure.
could do multiple Batman getting together or something like that. I still think they should do a Spider-Verse movie for Marvel.
I think they should, too.
Yeah, that could be really cool.
Yeah.
I forgot to mention that Raven Metzner, who is a producer on Sleepy Hollow, will be taking over Iron Fist.
Okay.
Hopefully drain the douche.
Swamp. Yes.
Drain the douche swamp. Hashtag drain the douche swamp. Douche swamp. And one last item that we'll mention before we move on to talking about some of those trailers is that it turns out that Captain Marvel, the upcoming film starring Brie Larson for Marvel, will be set in the 90s.
Okay.
Because so for hot right reason. Now. They're trying to beat X-Men to it, maybe.
Okay.
And it will feature the Skrulls.
Interesting.
Yeah, that was the most interesting thing for me. Period piece, interesting. The fact that it will establish that Captain Marvel has been a hero before Iron Man, before everybody else, before Cap was unfrozen. Like, she will be the new first modern hero of the Marvel Universe, which is
fascinating. That's a good point.
Yeah, and she has to have been around for a while in order to attain the rank of Captain, right?
Right.
There's no way that some guy would just get frozen and they just start calling him Captain.
No.
You don't get a promotion for getting frozen.
Right.
Or for punching out a guy playing Hitler at the USO 200 times. So, yeah, that interests me. All that interests me. Seeing Brie Larson play like an older character, if they try to age her up, might be interesting. The Skrulls is what gets me. Because the Skrulls are generally accepted to be a Fantastic Four property.
Right.
The Fox owns them, at least as far as we ever knew. So this seems to be evidence of more horse trading behind the scenes.
Yes.
A la Negasonic Teenage Warhead and Quicksilver and
the Scarlet Witch.
Scarlet Witch, yeah. And all these sort of characters that they... what do you got? You got some chips? I'll trade you my apple, that sort of thing.
Right.
And that's good news. It also means that it's good news that they've sort of cracked the vault for Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
Characters.
I agree.
Because if they are going to make... if they're making a Doom movie, they've got Fantastic Four plans. They must.
They have to.
Richards! Who's he talking about? I don't know who he's talking about. but it means that they're open to giving away things that they don't know what to do with.
That's true.
And the Skrulls will be a great addition to the sort of galaxy-spanning Captain Marvel. They're going to show up in Guardians 3. They're going to have to.
Yeah.
So that'll be cool. And who knows? Maybe we'll get a little... gray-templed, wife-neglecting super scientist showing up to fight Thanos.
Maybe.
It could happen.
It could happen.
It could happen. Mick World. Let's talk about some trailers that came out of SDCC. So many trailers. And there's no way that we can talk specifically about them all, but we can kind of mention, like I said, there was the Defenders trailer. Thor Ragnarok, a new trailer for that.
Yeah.
How can I be more interested in the third Thor movie than I was in the first or second?
I don't know.
And how is it possible that their trailers continue to get better and better?
I don't know, but they do. They draw you in. They make you interested in seeing what's going to happen, and you genuinely care about this character and like his relationship with the Hulk.
Well, I don't know if I really care about Thor, but I love everything that they're showing us in these trailers.
Yeah. I do, too. And, like, you see more about his relationship with Hulk in this trailer.
Yeah.
And
Hulk talks, too.
I know.
Yeah.
While he's the Hulk.
Yeah.
Which is something we haven't really seen before.
Yeah. It is not just puny god or whatever, although I'm sure they'll try to sneak that back in.
Right.
It's really great. You've got these, you got Peyton Reed or whatever. You've got, I don't want to pick on anybody, but you got these kind of undistinguished directors that they bring in and just tell them what to do, and they make a movie.
Right.
Sir, you've done it. And then you get guys like James Gunn, you get guys like Taika Waititi, who are funny and creative and certainly fans and have their own ideas, and you let them run wild, and you get things like Guardians of the Galaxy, Thor Ragnarok.
Yes.
Carl Urban. And one thing that I love is that I think if you have patience, Marvel will reward you, because you go, why couldn't we get something now? Well, we didn't have the rights till now.
Right.
But it would have been too much. It would have been a Spider-Man 3 situation, like overpacking something.
Sure.
And so the fact that how has Cate Blanchett not been a Marvel villain or even character up to this point?
I have no
idea. Why did we wait 11 years?
Yeah.
And the fact is that because it's awesome. Like right now, like she looks fantastic.
Yeah.
And is going to be really great. There was a longer trailer, an extended trailer for Marvel's Inhumans show that we saw coming out of San Diego Comic-Con. What'd you think?
I still think the hair looks stupid.
It looks awful.
It looks dumb. And when it moves, it looks even worse.
Yeah. It's like you saved money on the wig. Fine. Spend it on the CGI. Looks worse than the wig.
Yeah.
So, yeah. I am getting really worried about this show now. This trailer is longer and more extensive, and it looks worse than the last one.
I'm just worried because I feel like they've overextended themselves. Something that needs a lot of production and that sort of thing. And
yeah,
I feel like it looks cheap.
Yeah, it does. I mean, they think they've definitely done what they could to try to make it, you know, on budget. But yeah, you have to kind of pick your shots, I think, in terms of what you're going to show for CGI. And they spend it all on the teleport.
Yeah.
The teleport effect.
Exactly.
All I have to do is have a bright flash of light. We did it.
Yeah.
Thanks, Lockjaw.
We don't need a whole lot.
I know. Speaking about spending on stuff, this one came out late, so you might not have seen it, but there was a trailer for The Gifted, the new Fox mutant show.
Okay.
Which is basically an X-Men show in all but name. And in the trailer, it's got a lot of interesting effects. It looks like it could be going somewhere. And it features mutants like Eclipse, Thunderbird, Polaris, and Blink. They're all in this one trailer.
Okay.
Yeah. But forget about that. Forget that shit. Here comes Mongo. The Justice League trailer is out.
Yes.
The 1, 2, 3, 4. How many is this now?
I don't know.
It's the new one. It's the only one that matters.
It's the new one.
It's like 4 minutes long.
It's really long.
Yeah. What'd you think of that?
Looks epic. I don't know. I guess I'm more excited about the Wonder Woman parts than just about anything.
Yeah.
Which kind of tells you something. Like
she kicks a guy's ankle out.
Of course.
That's her move.
That's her go-to move.
Yeah.
Aquaman looks pretty cool in this.
Yeah. And we on the Wonder Woman note, we see more of Themyscira and Connie Nielsen's back.
Yes.
And yeah, yeah.
So that's cool. So we know Themyscira is going to be in it.
I feel like Cyborg is hard to sell, but I think that he's going to stand out in this.
Okay.
I'm actually not super familiar with the actor's work.
I'm worried about Cyborg because
oh, really?
I feel like the special effects are not
Oh, I thought they
great.
Looked a lot better in this one.
Okay.
It's just my opinion, but I think that he's going to... I'm sorry. This is a comparison in terms of being a sort of lateral character who is sort of stoic, but he's the Black Panther in my mind.
Okay.
Not because of color necessarily, although maybe they can only write Black characters as standoffish and reticent, but he seems like he's going to be the people who are going, that guy's pretty cool. Like, he outcools Batman.
Okay.
That's my pitch.
All right.
Coming out of nowhere.
Okay.
But we see a lot more. We see some more fight scenes. And again, still no storyline. No clue.
No.
And no clue what this movie's
about.
That's
kind of what worries me.
It is very worrying, yes.
Especially, like, they went to the trouble of making this trailer like 4 minutes long, and we have no idea what the plot is going to be like whatsoever.
Yep. I think all they have is they're finding it in the edit, as they say.
Yeah.
Which is not good for a $250 million movie.
No.
And one more thing, they heavily tease the return of Superman.
Yeah.
But not in a good way. Like, even trailers have post-credit scenes now.
Right.
And there's just a scene of Jeremy Irons going, oh, I thought you'd come back. And And there's no, they don't give us like a little flip of red cape or anything. We're just supposed to, they're playing on this as like a known.
Oh, it's you.
Yeah, right. Right. Not you. Bum, bum, bum.
Yeah.
But they're playing on it as a known secret. And that makes me wonder if maybe they're playing on our expectations. But they're not that smart.
I don't think so.
No, they've proven they're not that smart. So, yeah, Superman's going to be in this. Big surprise. Let's talk about a real surprise, the debut of the Ready Player One trailer.
Okay.
Familiar with the book?
I'm not familiar with the book.
Me either. Told to read it many times. Heard it was going to be adapted into a film and thought, I'll see you in the film. But, yeah, it is produced by directed by Steven Spielberg. And it is, I gather that the story is essentially, it's a future semi-crapsack world where a kid, like, goes online. And, like, online gaming is what the kids do. The missing generation.
Right.
They get out there and they play on the cyber world and do stuff like that.
Yeah.
This is certainly a teaser, so we don't have a plot summary. Everybody who's read the book knows what it is, but I assume a kid learns something about himself.
Yes. He's
fighting Freddy Krueger. Interesting note that there's a lot of intellectual property in this film that is from other places. Like we see, like the Iron Giant is in this film.
Yes.
Can anyone explain? Was that in the book?
I have no idea.
We sound like big dumbos. But anyway.
I
bet it probably was. So yeah, the DeLorean from Back to the Future's in it. I've heard somebody says that they see Harley Quinn in it.
Really?
So there's going to be a lot of like side licensing deals, I think. But that's fun.
Yeah.
You know what it reminds me of? It reminds me of, and this takes me back, but it reminds me of, what's it called? Last Action Hero.
Oh, okay.
In Last Action Hero, this kid goes to Movie World. He gets sucked into a movie screen with a movie ticket, magical ticket. And he goes to Movie World where he's hanging out with Jack Slater, played by Arnold Schwarzenegger, and he's like the greatest cop ever. And in the movie universe, all movies sort of come together as one. So as he's going into the police station, he sees like Sharon Stone in her Basic Instinct outfit is like lighting up outside the station.
Oh my gosh.
And then like Robert Patrick in the T2 police uniform, like walks by very briskly on his way to find John Connor, of course.
Sure.
So you get this idea that all these worlds are enmeshed, and that's kind of what I thought of.
Yeah, that sounds very similar.
So if this book for kids is trying to hook old men with 80s and 90s nostalgia, they nailed it. They nailed it, exactly. There was also, moving to the TV side, a trailer for Westworld.
Yes.
I feel like this Westworld won't come out until next year sometime.
That's right.
So this was also like a TV tease.
Yes.
And it was clearly like
for sure
things that probably wouldn't actually be in the show. Because why would they have like a long shot of Jeffrey, what's his name's character, like
Jeffrey
riding
Wright.
in a dune buggy, just kind of looking at nothing.
Yeah,
like,
I don't
that
know.
That doesn't really do anything.
I don't know.
But the park has gone to hell.
Yes.
Speaking of crap sacks, this is it. Like, this is, it has become dystopic.
Mm-hmm.
And there's an interesting blending of elements. There's one point where he's looking down at, like, a dead tiger that's washed up.
Yeah, which I just, like, makes no, like,
on the shore.
Are we going lost on this thing? Like,
well, yeah, there's Lost World.
Yeah.
Oh, well, there's already Lost World, but there's Lost D World or something.
Right.
Where you just look for a hatch the entire time.
Right.
And go home really disappointed.
Right.
After having spent all that money. And invested that time. Meta, there's also a, speaking of meta, there is a trailer for Stranger Things 2.
Yes.
It's not called second season, it's just called Stranger Things 2.
Yes.
Although, if they really wanted to rip off the 80s, it needs a subtitle.
You're correct.
Yeah.
It does. Getting Stranger, or something.
Stranger Things 2, The Teen Warriors, or something like that.
Something, yeah. Yeah.
Teen Kid Squad, Teen Boy Squad, which is more 80s than it's ever been.
Yeah.
We see Dragon's Lair, the video game.
That's right.
Which I had to explain to you a couple months ago.
You did.
But now you've seen it in action.
Yeah.
They're all dressed up like Ghostbusters.
Yep.
Yeah. It's just going to be more of that.
These
kids are going to lose their minds. If there's a Stranger Things 3, they're going to be wearing orange vests and trying to hoverboard. I guess that's a few years down the road, but you know what I mean.
Yes, I do.
You're going to see some serious shit. And we also saw a trailer for Star Trek Discovery. This is the new big trailer.
That's right.
Tell me about that.
It's more, you see more of the Klingons, the new Klingons, which I'm not really a fan
you
of.
Like them?
That they redesigned them.
I think it was Harberts. Aaron Harberts is one of the showrunners and producers, and he said, yeah, I mean, they're kind of different. But look, every time the Klingons have come back, we've done something to them. And
that's
so
true.
They're introducing, I guess, the idea that there are different sort of houses, you know?
Okay.
I mean, there's already houses like the House of Moog and stuff like that.
Right.
But maybe like they're different sort of breeds and species who like commingle.
Sure.
And who knows? We learn or we continue to learn in this trailer that our main character, Michael Burnham, has done something she shouldn't have.
Yes.
She has caused what I'm guessing is some kind of intergalactic incident
yes.
that maybe leads to a lot of those smooth-faced Klingons getting wiped out. Who knows? We don't know. But for the first time in a long time, I feel really good about this. It just
okay.
looks... It's the total, you know, movie aesthetic, but what are you going to do? But I think they're committed to it fitting in the story, the canon that we know so far.
Sure.
It looks exciting. It looks like there's going to be intrigue.
The costumes look great.
Yeah. Still haven't seen James Frain as not a hologram. I don't know if he'll ever physically be in this show. And we also learn, and I don't think this was in the trailer, this was mentioned at a panel at the show, but she is the adoptive daughter of Sarek and Amanda Grayson.
Oh, really?
Which makes her Spock's foster sister or stepsister or whatever you want to say.
Yeah, now, that's interesting.
It is interesting, but pretty big retcon.
Yeah.
Unless she gets Felicity Jones out of this thing, spoilers for Rogue One, how do they explain where she's been all this time?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
Good question.
So,
I mean, we'll Spock does have another brother. Who...
Yeah, well, and we know, Kirk says, I know you don't have a brother.
I know.
I have a stepbrother. Really, Spock, is this the time to play little word games?
Exactly.
But we never mentioned sister, so there you go.
Yeah. Not great sibling relations at the Spock household.
Well, before we talk about Valerian and the city of like 37 planets tops, I did want to drop in here our interview with Emma Bull from CVG this year. We talk to her every year. This year, she wanted to sort of mix it up a little bit and add an ongoing element, which I was all for.
Yeah.
So when you start hearing stuff that you don't understand what we're talking about and you're worried that something really bad happened at the con, don't worry about it.
Just go with it.
It's a bit of improvisational theater.
Yes.
And well, here's our interview. The theme of the con this year is space opera. How would you define space opera? I've heard a lot of different sort of takes on it.
Space opera is mostly about, it's about big picture. It's about a big sweeping vision. The idea of opera is kind of like, well, it's sort of like Peking opera. There's this sense of larger than life people and emotions.
There's
and
an adjective, operatic. Sure.
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And that idea that space opera used to be a derogative term where it was all, oh, yeah, your mighty heroes going out across the universe. And why don't we concentrate on real scientific stuff? And it's, real scientific stuff is great. Kim Stanley Robinson, wonderful, real scientific stuff. But there are times when you want that, I'm going to spread my mentally cyber-controlled wings, and I'm going to fly off into a completely unknown galaxy.
Sure.
And there will be whole new ways of governing interplanetary governments. There will be wonderful anarchic sorts of things. One of the great things about Firefly was that I think it made really good use, the TV show Firefly.
Interesting, yeah.
Really good use of space opera because they were able to contrast that, okay, we have a very order-centered central government, and then the further out you got from the center of the galaxy, the more you had a chaos-aligned sort of pioneer world.
Sure.
And I think that was a really natural thing.
That's very operatic.
Yeah.
Something about Firefly, though, is that it's not exactly hard sci-fi, but they seem to cleave more to a more realistic sort of no sound in space, you know, no artificial gravity, that sort of thing.
The food is kind of significant that way.
Yeah. They get really excited when they get apples or fruit.
Look, it's strawberries. This is like solid gold.
Yeah.
And there's the horrible birthday cake made out of unspecified protein.
Yeah, right.
Really kind of nasty.
You know, like a meatloaf. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I've always heard that space opera is kind of like fantasy set in space. You have like fantastical elements.
It certainly can.
Those Campbellian sort of things where you've got a character who's got to go out and get the whatever.
And I think that veers over into fantasy. You get to some of the later, now I'm really showing my age when I talk about the Lensman series.
Oh, sure.
Classic of this stuff. An awful lot of that was very fantasy-oriented. A lot of kind of superheroic powers that weren't really in the field of strict science extrapolation.
But that was like the 30s and 40s, right? So it still had that sort of men of science using science powers.
Yes, it did.
That are not scientific at all.
We're going to science the hell out of that.
Right.
Yes, indeed.
And I think it really makes sense that that influenced like Green Lantern so much.
Oh, yeah.
Because now Green Lantern is a comic book hero, and his ring thing can do whatever. And technically, there's a scientific explanation, but it's just,
but it's
just
a
magic.
Ring, for crying out loud. It's a ring.
Yeah,
what?
Right.
And part of the fun of superheroes is that they really are very much related to the idea of space opera. Mm-hmm. That kind of, well, Alan Moore referred to them and in his universes as science heroes.
Right.
With that idea that behind it, okay, the Flash got his speed powers from a combination of chemicals and lightning and et cetera.
Yeah.
Superman is an alien. He's from another planet. Mm-hmm. This is, you know, this is strictly science fiction stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Batman is a technocrat. And so all of that fits into the idea of heroes as scientific, science fiction stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so much of the old heroes were like that. I mean, even when you got things like Plastic Man, who was completely loony and cartoon-like and
right.
absolutely marvelous, there was a kind of a token science background.
Right.
So, yeah, there's a really strong relationship back to space opera.
Sure.
From those comic heroes.
And even those comic heroes are mythological in nature because they have the talisman or Batman as the lost son returning and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
It all ties together, man. Is
well,
this the
it
kind
does.
Of thing that you
is
this the kind of thing that you talk to your students about? Can you talk about your teaching work?
Yes, I teach at Hamline University. I teach specifically usually fantasy writing because there was a really big interest among the students in the creative writing programs there in writing fantasy and science fiction. And they came to me and they said, well, would you actually teach this? Because we teach writing, but can you teach some of the specific things? And I usually end up really just teaching writing, only I talk a lot about science fiction because, you know, you write characters.
Yeah, right.
Some of them are wizards and some of them have telepathic powers and some of them, you know. But it's hard to say what it is that I talk to them about because we end up every term having these great conversations about things.
Sure.
And the students bring in stuff that they say, okay, so here's this TV show. I want to talk about the writing on this TV show and why they did that. And we will stop and we'll talk about character motivation and we'll talk about the way plot arcs work and all kinds of great stuff. And every single year, every term that I teach, I learn really great stuff from my students.
Huh.
I feel like I'm cheating the hell out of this thing because it's just, they're really smart, they're really well read, and I come in going, okay, so tell me about that series that I haven't read yet. You tell me about it, and let's relate it to the things that we're talking about in class.
Sure.
We're talking about plot and point of view and kinds of stories and maintaining reader trust in the writer, which is really fun in science fiction because you're starting off saying, I am going to lie my ass off to you.
Right.
I really am. That's what this entire book is about.
Right.
My latest happy place, of course, is the Wonder Woman movie, which is...
Yes. Sure, of course.
Oh, God. Not only did they make a Wonder Woman movie, they made a really good Wonder
Woman
movie.
And it's successful. It's incredibly successful. So win in every column there.
Absolutely.
That was actually going to be my question.
Yes. I got.
So I
went
you're
to see
a big
it,
Wonder Woman fan.
I went to see it the week that it opened, and then my sister, who is now living in the same town with me, said, you know, I'd really like to go see Wonder Woman. And I said, yes, you would, and we're going together. So we made a big day of it, and we went out there, and she and I just came out of the theater grinning, and we had to sit down over coffee and say, okay, and that bit there where she does this, that was so great. Oh, that was just, we just had this wonderful sort of bonding fest over, yes, that's the Wonder Woman movie we wanted. One of the things that really impresses me with it is that they never fell back on that, oh, she's from a lost magic island, she doesn't understand the 20th century, haha. They brought her into the 20th century, and in fact, she didn't understand. But the things that she guessed and extrapolated, I mean, she comes into a women's clothing and things store,
yes,
and she looks at a 1917 corset and says, is this your form of armor? And suddenly you start looking at corsets saying, Yeah, kind of. But she was always smart. She was always, competent, you expect from Wonder Woman. But there was never that feeling of, oh, let's make fun of the outsider. Let's in some way make her cute. She was always a really realistic character with her own issues, with her own emotional... When she leaves Themyscira, there is this wonderful sense that you get from the actress of she is growing up, but she's not there yet. There's a kind of very smart, very strong, defiant teenager quality.
Yeah, that was a big part of
that it. That you never see again in the movie because she grows past it.
Mm-hmm.
They just did wonderful things with it.
What did you think about her sort of origin or the way they adapted the character?
I was very impressed. Somebody else I saw online pointed out they spend a lot of time on the Greek gods and not so much on the goddesses.
Mm, yeah.
Which it's true, is kind of sad. But I really loved the turnaround in the origin. That they start with the made her out of clay. Mm. And what they do with that, I think, is really very good.
Mm-hmm.
And that she discovers who she is exactly at the point where that could either make her or break her.
Right.
The whole Ares subplot I thought was very strong.
Mm-hmm.
That yes, this is historically back from the William Moulton, what the heck was his
Marston?
Name? Marston. Okay, yeah. Thank you. Phew. That from the beginning, Ares was, as the god of war, was the person behind World War II. And so translating that into the movie with the idea that the world is still actively controlled by gods, so it must be Ares, so he must be there.
Right. To her, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I thought that was that played out really well, and I'm trying so hard not to do spoilers. Oh, I'm trying so hard.
It's been out for a while.
Yeah.
I respect that, though.
It is, but still, you know, I want people to have the same fun that I had the first time I saw that movie.
Sure. I hadn't thought about, or I guess I thought about it a little, when they redid her origin in 2011 or whatever it was for the New 52, and they made her a demigoddess, you know, a daughter of Zeus. In the original... Moulton Marston, but also in the George Perez reboot, it was the goddesses that empowered her. You know, the six goddesses all gave
and
her strength.
At the point at which I discovered Wonder Woman, which was in the 60s, sometime in the 60s,
sure.
mumble 60s.
Okay.
That was the Andrew Esposito Wonder Woman for the most part. Mm. And there was always this sense of Aphrodite and Athena were always there. Kind of looking over the island. Mm-hmm. And they always had input into what the Amazons were doing, and
right.
that those were their patrons.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's reasonable, and yet that would have really set the Amazons much more apart, much more isolated, if it was only women with goddesses with... It would have been segregation, really.
Okay. Well, they are sort
not completely serious, but that feeling that the gods made the Amazons not to be separate and only female, but to be the secret weapon in times of threat to
sure.
the whole world, not just to women.
Yeah. And the gods in mythology are not great people. It's one of the things that I love
really
about,
not. Really
about
not.
Greek mythology and Roman mythology is that they're just human beings that can throw
and
lightning
Norse
bolts.
Mythology.
Oh,
mean,
sure.
How does Baldur die? His family thinks it's funny because he's, like, completely invulnerable.
Right.
So they'll throw things at him.
Right.
What kind of family is this? Oh, jeez.
A Norwegian one.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. Yeah, we drank a lot of beer and we ate a lot of lutefisk and we threw things at our brother. It was super cool until, oops.
No mistletoe allowed.
That's right.
Is there anything you're looking forward to at the con this year?
You know, you don't want to wish the very worst on people, but I'm kind of hoping that there will be another zombie incursion. I mean, obviously, there's a lot of attraction. There are a lot of brains assembled here in the convention. And there hasn't been that kind of assemblage since last year.
Right.
So I'm kind of hoping that the zombies will make a shot, because it was just so great last year to watch over there in Atrium 1, man. Those folks who are watching anime, they were ready with the speed lines, and they showered them down on the zombies coming in through the north entrance. And it was just, it was just Oh, it just made you feel so good.
There's a lot of brains here. We're like a golden corral for zombies.
Absolutely fabulous. And I'm really hoping that there will be something for folks who maybe missed last year. Mm-hmm. It was a really great bonding experience. It was really exciting, and it just made us all feel so good.
Sure.
And, you know, it's not likely. The Google self-driving cars are out there on Highway 100 and 494.
Right.
And since they went rogue, they pretty much hit anything that's not made out of metal.
Yeah, uneasy truce with them right now. As long as they're hitting zombies, it's okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
And you can get in and out, but, you know, you have to do it in a car because otherwise they don't want you.
Right. But I think that's the one time it's okay to remove the peace bonding on your weapon is when the con's attacked by zombies.
Absolutely. And the other great thing is that the folks in the dealer's room, the leather makers, have been doing a really good job supplying people with body armor. I mean, you know, we've got braces and things. It's like, you know, yeah, bite through this, sucker.
Right.
And so we've got, you know, there's a really strong feeling of everybody coming together in a crisis. And
sure.
It's been just a really great year. We've all gotten to know each other a lot better because, well, you have to because we can't leave the hotel.
Right.
But it's just, yeah, it's been a wonderful experience.
Yeah, hygiene hasn't really been a problem.
No,
and,
really.
Right.
And yeah. we're all comfortable here, and all of our friends are here. And I don't know. It's just, it's really, really, you know, as much as I love conventions, it's just really changed my attitude toward how we're a community and a family, and we can survive all kinds of stuff together. It's just great.
Yeah, and which pieces in the art show are edible. And
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we're at that point now.
Yeah.
So
it's a little tough for people who are at the outlying hotels, who are in the overflow hotels.
Yes.
We've lost a few of them. It's kind of sad. We've got a memorial downstairs for people who we've lost, but, you know,
right.
We've retired their badges. But we're doing okay, really.
You think it's hard to wait for a shuttle now? Just wait till a zombie apocalypse is coming down on you.
I'm hoping that when we talk again next year, if we do, if you survive.
Sure.
I mean, I hope your name doesn't end up on the wall. That would make me very sad.
Well.
But, you know, next year we'll find out how we made it through the last year and what changes have happened.
I can't wait. Thanks again for talking with us. We always enjoy running into you at the con.
Thank you. I'm always very pleased to be able to talk with the Just Enough Trope folks and the miracle of podcasting in this new, amazing, modern age. Don't get bit.
It's fantastic. Don't get bit. Don't get bit. What if Zeus was one of us?
That sounds like...
Just a stranger.
What if God
on the
was
bus.
One of us?
And he's got a pass, and you can bring somebody along, so his lightning bolt rides for free. Or like Ganymede. Like if Ganymede and Zeus, if I put them in a show now, Ganymede would have a Bluetooth in his ear and a clipboard and just be following Zeus around.
Right.
Be like Zeus's assistant.
Pretty much.
So it's like, what do I got now? You've got a 10:30 with Hyperion, so you got to really get to that. Yeah. We don't have time for this. But no, great talking to her, and we thank her for being on the show. And if you want to check her out online, you can. I mean, you can search for her. She's there. She's on Amazon, her books and her works. You can also find her at Coffee M, like coffee, the word coffee, E-M, on Twitter. And I think she's got a WordPress blog as well. So thanks, Emma. Great talking to you.
I'm an alligator. I'm a mama, papa coming for you. I'm a space invader. I'll be a rock and rolling bitch for you.
How many planets we got? We need more planets. Guys, we're so short on planets. Okay, well, let's just go with what we have. Let's talk about Valerian and the City of 1,000 Planets. Going into this, what did you know?
I knew it was directed by Luc Besson.
Who's that?
He's a French director who did The Fifth Element, among other films.
Amongst other films, yes.
Yes, I knew it was going to be visually stunning.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's got that going for it.
Yeah. And that's about it. I knew it was French.
Yeah, well, it's very French. It's funny how anybody who is not a face that you recognize in space is a French person.
Yeah.
Did you notice that?
Yes.
So, it has not done well. It's grossed about $17 million in this opening weekend on an estimated $200 million budget.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah. That's real bad. It's not great.
No.
we could have waited and done this on Craft Disservices in a year or so. We're doing it now. Yeah. It's written and directed by Luc Besson, based on the long-running comic book or comic strip Valerian and Larlene.
Yep.
Which is also French, by Pierre Christine and Jean-Claude Mezman. Call him the Mezman. My friends call him the Mezman. I'm trying to get him to let me call him that. About space cops, basically.
Yes.
It's set hundreds of years in the future. I think it varies. In this adaptation, it's set about 400 or 500 years in the future.
Yep.
And they work for like the Federal Galactic Authority, doing space cop stuff. It's pretty much what you'd think.
Yes.
And, you know, we talked about space opera with Emma. This firmly fits into space. This is space opera.
Yes.
With no question.
Yeah.
The sort of soft science,
large,
epic,
sweeping,
multi-system spanning empire. Yeah. Saving worlds and that sort of thing. To its credit, that's probably the most fun part about it. Well, we'll talk about that. It stars Charisma Black Hole, Dane DeHaan. And what is she doing here? Cara Delevingne as the leads, Valerian and Laureline. What are they doing here?
I don't know.
Not great.
No.
You know, I don't know. To me, Dane DeHaan still looking for a good movie. Actually, you know, he was in The Place Beyond the Pines, wasn't he? And I thought that that movie was okay.
Okay.
For being a Ryan Gosling movie. But otherwise, yeah. Why does this guy keep getting roles?
I have no idea.
I'm not a huge fan.
No.
And, you know, he's just like, if he stopped talking like this for like 1 second, would his voice be like this?
I don't know.
He's a little guy, and I don't know, maybe I speak from experience, but sometimes you try to pitch your voice down a little bit, and he's like, yeah, look, I'm just a space cop, you know? I just like to do my job like a space cop. But if he stopped doing that, would he just be like, we gotta save this planet?
I hope he wouldn't sound like Mickey Mouse.
Okay, I can do a Mickey Mouse. Don't force me. It also stars Clive Owen, Ethan Hawke, for some reason.
Yeah.
For some reasons will continue. Herbie Hancock plays a pretty big role in this. You know, Herbie Hancock? Why?
I don't know.
And Rutger Hauer is in it for about 45 seconds.
Okay.
45 seconds. Master thespian of stage and screen. Hey, everybody, this is what happens in space now. Goodbye, I won't be in this anymore. And I doubt he got Marlon Brando money for that.
No, probably not.
Yeah, and then, of course, Rihanna's in this.
Yes.
We'll talk about that in a little bit. What happens in Valerian and the city of... two. Look, we got two planets. I know for sure there's two planets they get to.
Well, he has this vision in the beginning of this planet that gets destroyed. And there's this princess there, and she imprints herself on him, like her soul or
something
like that.
The vision
like
is
that.
The opener of the film.
Yes. And it's gorgeous, this paradise island.
They're kind of
or
fish
planet.
People? Or...
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're aquatic
right.
somehow.
Littoral.
Yes.
They live... along the beaches, and don't worry about it.
Yeah. Then they have to go on this mission that is actually related to that.
They don't know it.
They don't know it, but they have to get this converter, which is an animal, a mule converter that like converts whatever you feed it.
It just poops out a million of them.
Yeah. It's like really gross when you think about
it. We're really doing this. Oh, keep going. It's also very cute, and clearly, you know, at some point somebody went, this is, every kid's going to have a plushie of this.
Yes.
They're going to be sticking their favorite Dora DVDs in there, hoping a million poop out.
Yes.
But I don't think it's going to happen.
No. Could you imagine like a Hungry Hungry Hippos version?
It's sort of the anti-Hungry Hungry Hippo.
Yeah.
Because... and this isn't ruining anything, but one of the things that the mule, I think that, isn't that the name of the people?
I think so. The planet is mule.
Anyway, the fish people, they have a bead, bath bead based currency.
Yes.
Because they harvest these beads.
These pearls.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then they feed it to the thing and it spits them out. So it's the opposite because a hungry hippo eats all the pearls.
That's true.
I think we unlocked the secret of this película. Keep going.
So they basically go into what is it called? It's the market.
Big market.
Big market. Yeah. They go into big market.
I love big market.
And Valerian gets the converter and the pearl.
Yeah.
And then they have to try to get out.
Right.
And they have a lot of trouble getting out.
Yeah. I'm listening to this because I want to know what the movie was about.
Right.
And I also want to know what you think it was about, because that's about as much of a plot summary that we can give without spoiling it. We won't spoil anything.
Sure.
That's the first act.
Yes.
There is a last act that is spoilers, and the middle is, you can't hear me shrug on air.
Yeah.
The middle is just bullshit.
Yeah.
It's just things running around and stuff happening.
Yeah.
And then Rihanna.
Yeah. Don't forget Rihanna.
It's literally just moving from sort of, you know, what I hesitate to call set piece to set piece.
Yeah.
Because it's a mess.
It is a mess.
It's a beautiful mess.
It is a gorgeous mess.
Yeah, it looks fantastic.
Yes.
And supposedly, I don't know, a lot of directors begin as artists.
Yes.
And so I don't know if he, I know that he began as a scuba diver. This movie is dedicated to his father. Sorry, his dad. And his father, both of his parents were scuba divers.
Oh, okay.
And so he was very into scuba diving until he was injured somehow, I don't know, in his teens, and couldn't be a scuba diver. And so he had to look for another career, and he found filmmaking. But so I don't know if he was an artist, but I know that he wrote like a 600-page sort of treatment or Bible for what all the elements of this thing would be.
Sure.
So I think it was definitely a Lucas or a Lucasian type thing, where, except for Lucas just put his stamp on things that other people created. I think it's the opposite. Much like the Chris Hardwick and the Harrison Ford polemic, he came up with all this stuff and then gave it to the things. So like when Laureline and Bob are in a submarine somewhere in an aquatic part of Alpha, the city of 1,000 planets, and they are trying to pull a jellyfish out of a giant sea bug's blowhole.
Yes.
I bet he came up with all that.
I bet he did too.
And just said, come back to me with 15 blowhole designs. I want to see all the blowholes. Come on, let's do this. So yeah, there's so much going on. The movie is 137 minutes long. And that's like 37 minutes too long.
Right.
Like, you know, it's so bad, but it was long. But you don't want to hear that.
No, you don't want to hear that.
The food was terrible, and the portions are so small. So it screws around for quite a lot of it. You forgot to mention that the technology is spaceman, but the sexual politics are caveman.
Oh, yes. There is that.
Loreline does not a lot in this film. They are ostensibly equal. I mean, he's a major or whatever, but he's her superior. But they are both space cops.
Yes.
And this movie finds every excuse it can to be like, all right, Loreline, I'll shoot all these guys. You go call for help.
Right.
Or like, I don't feel like shooting guys. Go get him, big boy. And he gets out there. And she does very little in the film.
Yeah.
And the entire film, it's this whole, he's pursuing her. Why don't you go on a date with me? Why don't you sleep with me or marry me? And she's like, I don't think so. And then at the end, he gets rewarded with sex.
Yeah.
For winning.
Yes.
I don't mean for this to turn into feminist frequency, but come on.
Yeah, I know.
French people, what's going on?
I don't know.
Why is it always like this?
I don't know.
Not to mention the weird coding of different aliens that aren't humans as like ethnic sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Appropriation. Okay, let's skip to the end. I enjoyed this, and I think you should probably go see it, but I'm going to squeeze every complaint I can out of it before we get there.
Okay.
I don't feel like any of it was meant to be harmful, but it is, in this day and age, looks like, come on. Like, the fish people they're coded as, you know, they're a tribe.
Yes.
And so they are, you know, they're noble savages.
Right.
They have spears, and they like have beaded, you know, elaborate necklaces, and wear, you know, furs and leathers and loincloth and stuff like that.
Right.
And they're whiter than Caucasian people.
Yeah.
And right off the bat, it's like, I know they're aliens, but it's not great. And later on, they meet this incredibly stupid race that lives in the bowels of Alpha.
Right.
who also have feathers and loincloths and spears, and they are very dark-skinned and very yes. big-lipped.
That's true.
And very troublesome to this reviewer.
That is, yes, because they eat humans.
And they're cannibals.
Yeah.
That's not spoiling.
Yeah, no.
Not important.
No.
So yeah, white people are the best. They are noble. They deserve to survive and be preserved.
Yeah.
Valerian in the City of 1,000 Appropriations. Not great. Has Cara Delevingne ever seen a good script?
I don't think so.
I feel like every single movie she's been in has been bad.
Yeah.
Would she even know at this point?
No.
Let's talk about the script. Let's talk about the performances. I'd love to blame this solely on the leads, how wooden and bad it is. But if you read, and we will, next week we'll be talking about the comic book,
yes.
Valerian and Laureline. The script is terrible,
yeah.
but it does match the sort of gee whiz, possibly translated from another language, matter-of-fact dialogue of the four-color comic book. Yeah. It just doesn't translate to screen. Here's your chance to take a 50-year-old property and jazz it up. So I want to blame it all on the leads, but the script is really bad too.
Yeah, it is.
It doesn't help.
It's really bad, and they're not great either.
They are not good.
No. I think their eyebrows do more acting than they do.
Well, yeah, the eyebrows should have top billing in this. Yeah. It's over their eyes, the top of their face. Yeah, that's not great. Again, why Ethan Hawke? Why are you in this?
I don't know. And it's such a small part. He plays
this. Yeah, he's like a pimp or like a club owner or something. It's such a tiny part.
It's such a tiny part. You blink, you
miss him. Is he a Besson fan?
Or something.
Did he go native while shooting all those Before movies in France with Julie Delpy?
Yeah, he must have.
He's over there and he's like, I love this comic book. This is great. Oh, we're doing what? All right.
I'm in.
Give me a hussar vest with glow sticks attached to the front, and I'm good to go.
Yeah, exactly.
It's fun. It's one of those things too, where, I mean, he's not great in it either, but he totally with his 12 lines upstages the two leads.
Yes.
Who are just trying to lead this film.
Yeah.
Just throwing him in. Once you get over the what is Ethan Hawke in goggles and a fedora doing in this film?
Yes.
And he's better than the star of the film.
Yeah.
So bad news. Dane, if you got a degree to fall back on, I say you blow it up, dust off your resume, just start thinking about other things. So let's get to Rihanna.
Yes.
Rihanna is in this movie. She shows up after the halfway point, I think.
Yeah.
In the aforementioned cabaret or whatever it is that Ethan Hawke runs, and she plays Bubble.
Yeah.
She is a creature, we find out, not really a spoiler, who can look like anything.
Yes.
But looks mostly like Rihanna in a succession of wigs.
Yeah.
And she's like a cabaret dancer. She doesn't like her life, and she gets a chance to do something different.
Yes.
Which leads to, like, the best 20 minutes of the film.
Yeah.
I really liked Rihanna in this.
Yeah, she was great.
I don't know what's wrong with my mouth. Do you hear what I hear?
Yeah, Drummer
Boy? Yeah, she was pretty good.
Yeah, she was.
And I really like the idea of her character, and maybe it's just because Valerian and Laureline are just glowering under their bushy brows at each other the entire film, and then she comes in, and I'm a little worried about Luc Besson. As she does this number, she kind of goes through these different sort of fantasy things, and it's just the first couple pages of a Fredericks of Hollywood catalog.
Yeah.
She's like, oh, she's a nurse. She's a French maid. In France, they call them maids. She's Catwoman at one point. And it's like this, the laziest. She's just wearing like a bodysuit and a whip. So I guess she's Catwoman.
Right.
Troubling.
It is troubling.
I mean, I guess we're judging the people, you know, the lower classes of Alpha here. The City of 1,000 Planets. But
I mean, she's also a schoolgirl.
She's also essentially a sex slave.
And
she's
a
non-white white slave.
Yes.
But she gets out.
Yes.
Yeah, schoolgirl. Not great.
No.
Hey, kids. There were some kids at this. The theater on a Sunday afternoon was way more full than I thought. There was a good 40 people there.
Sure.
So I thought word of mouth would have killed this by the end of the week. But I don't know. Maybe people are giving it a shot.
I mean, visually, it looks really cool.
It does. And that's what I would say.
Saw it in 3D.
I'd say give it a shot.
Yeah.
you don't, well, I guess we'll skip to recommendations. I'd say give it a shot. You do not need to spend the money on 3D.
No, I would agree.
I don't know if this was shot for 3D, but it adds nothing. I don't remember anything from it standing out 3D-wise. It is too long, like I said. It is a collection of things that happen, but those things that happen are... I hate saying turn your brain off. What I'll say instead is give to this film what it gives to you. Treat this film like a summer fling. Don't commit. Don't let your heart go. If you go to this movie, and I left the movie a couple times, because at one point, it's not necessarily the movie's fault. I was really tired, and I was starting to fall asleep.
Sure.
And they have those chairs that automatically recline.
Yes.
Bad combo. So I just got up and went and got some coffee and took my time doing it.
Yes.
Came back, still knew what was going on. Didn't feel like I'd missed anything.
Yep.
Later on, I went to the bathroom, came back. So I'd say, go see this film. If you are engrossed, stick with it. If you're not, it's 137 minutes. Get up, go get some candy floss, or candy, cotton candy, as we call it here in the States.
Right.
Come back in, see what's going on. Maybe get a hot dog later. Go get a smoke, see how you feel. Come back in. Yeah, it's like watching TV. Change the channel if you don't like it.
Sure.
You will find things you like, but you're not going to like all of it.
Yeah. I agree with you. I also got up and left and went to the restroom.
Yeah, but you missed something big that we can't talk about.
I know. I didn't pick my timing wisely. No. So that would be the one thing I would say about that. Just make sure you pick your timing wisely.
Yeah. So I don't know if this relates to any kind of rating, but I'd say worth a shot.
Yeah, go check it out.
Both of ours. We rate it very high on convincing voice. Oh, it's super good. Go check it out.
It's all right.
It's all right. One thing I have a specific complaint about that you can't blame on anything except for the people that made the movie, people that produced it, is that they didn't use enough music. And I think maybe they either got the... Usually I get sick of this, people just jamming pop songs now into a film to give it energy like Guardians of the Galaxy. But
right.
This could have really benefited from that.
I think so, too.
And they actually, there are a couple parts where there are pop songs or hints of pop songs.
Yeah.
At one end, but the selection doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
Like, he goes to the cabaret where Rihanna is literally going to dance for him for 2.5 minutes.
Yes.
Umbrella? Anything. Just buy a Rihanna song and let her sing it.
Yeah.
She didn't even get to sing.
No.
You cast a singer in this film. But instead, just before that, they played the Refugee All-Stars, Wyclef Jean, doing the remix of Staying Alive.
Yeah.
For some reason. And it's like, what a... First of all, huge deep cut. It was cheap, I guess?
I guess.
But then at the beginning of the film, it opens with Space Oddity, because...
Yeah.
They're in space.
Yes.
Come on.
And that's about it.
And also, people pick these songs and they have no idea what they're selling. This movie opens with Space Oddity, which is a song about an astronaut dying in space.
Yeah.
Bad choice. Yeah. We saw a car commercial before the film for Chevy or Ford or somebody about this family, first of all, morbid, driving across the America to dump Granny's ashes in the Pacific Ocean.
Yeah.
And it plays over America by Simon and Garfunkel, which is essentially a sequel to The Graduate. It's about two kids who get on a bus to head west and have no idea what they're looking for and find out they hate each other and are just completely lost on this bus. Depressing.
It's depressing.
It's not what you're looking for.
No.
So we're moving right along here in the show, heading towards our review of Aeon Flux from 2005. But we're stopping off at our interview with Naomi Kritzer and Lyda Morehouse.
That's right.
Very fortunate to be able to talk to these two. Have not talked to them before.
Yeah.
And they come to the show every year.
They do.
So I hope to talk to them again, and maybe we can get something going there, a regular thing, because they were great to talk to. Here's our interview.
M- my very first Convergence might have been Convergence 2. And the reason I remember that is because I believe Neil Gaiman was one of the guests of honor.
Yeah, I think he was.
Yeah, for 2.
For number 2.
And it was at a weird place. It was in downtown St. Paul.
Okay.
And I remember because I had just had my book published, and I was on a panel with Neil Gaiman, and I can't remember who else, but it was like somebody where I was like, I can't believe this is my first panel.
Yeah, hey, look at me.
And my funny story there is that I don't know if you've met Neil Gaiman, but he's at the time he was kind of a hottie, right?
Yeah, sure.
And I was sitting there and I was looking at him and I was thinking, oh, I kind of understand why you always wear sunglasses. It's those dreamy chestnut eyes.
You
got
to protect people from
and
them.
Then he turns to me and says, well, what do you think of this, Lyda? And I was like, don't even know what we're talking about.
Where are we?
But I managed to fake it and it was fine, but it was very hilarious. So.
Sure.
I think my first Convergence was actually Convergence 1. But I don't remember much about it. Like, it was so long ago.
Yeah.
And then I didn't come for years. There was, like, a long period of years where I didn't come because July is a time of year when I like doing outdoorsy things in Minnesota a lot of the time. But then my older daughter got really into coming to conventions, and so I started coming to Convergence because I was bringing her. And that was when I really became a regular attendee after she was about 8. She's 16 now.
The theme of the con this year is space opera, you know, to infinity and beyond. Are you guys space opera fans?
Yeah, I would say. I mean, it depends on how you define that, right?
It does, really. Yeah. And that's something else that I was going to ask you. How would you define space opera?
Well, see, for me, and when I teach science fiction and fantasy, I do try to define space opera.
Sure.
And it just is sort of like this epic in space. And if you do that, then it includes things like Star Wars, which, of course, I'm a fan of.
Yeah.
You know, and then there's all the Lois McMaster Richold books that are very classically space opera. Maybe. Would you call those? Yeah. Okay. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I really, really, really love Lois Bujold's Vorkosigan series, which is definitely space opera.
Yeah.
It's really excellent space opera that's kind of, you know, ruined me for a lot of other space opera because it's so good. I don't know how to define space opera. Like, it's space opera if it's like fun adventures with spaceships.
Right.
Right? I mean, it's kind of what it comes down to.
Does it have to have an empire is the question. Do you think it has to have an empire?
Does it have to be an empire?
No. No. I think you could definitely do space operas with, you know, democratically elected federations of whatever. I mean, I don't think you need any empire. I feel like most of the space opera I've run into has an empire in it somewhere.
Yeah,
like
that. Yeah. Right?
Well, now you think about it. Yeah.
Star Trek like has the Federation, which isn't an empire exactly, but like then you have the Klingon Empire and the Romulan Empire. So like, yeah, and like, I mean, the Vorkosigan series has the Beriar
and the Firefly doesn't quite. Like, would you consider Firefly space opera?
I don't know, because it feels...
Yeah, I would think. See, I totally think it fits parts of the trope.
I've always felt that the opera has to. It means that it has to have these Campbellian sort of things in it.
So you're heavy on the opera, less on the space.
Oh well, yeah. I suppose you're right.
Right?
Yeah, yeah. Having the like an empire and a untested person goes out, you know, gets the panacea or whatever, comes back. That's sort of the fantasy element. Only with technology set in space. But maybe that's too rigid a definition. I don't know.
It's one of those questions because I think recently there was a discussion. I think Eleanor Arneson was writing about it over on Strange Horizons about women and whether or not they write space opera and how many women you can trace, women writers have written space opera. And I think that starts to... Like, when you start defining it certain ways, it kind of, either excludes or includes women.
Sure.
And I'm not sure I know what those lines are or what those definitions are. But, like, I'm thinking about, you know, the first one we thought of was Lois Bujold. I think about Anne Leckie's stuff. That feels like space opera to me.
It really does. Yeah, it does.
You know?
Yeah.
Again, depending on how you define it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, you can argue that space opera is the kind of science fiction where the science, like, really doesn't matter that much. You know, like, Star Wars, people have described it as, like, you know, space wizards at war, which, I mean, is super fair. There is nothing scientific in Star Wars
that sounds
anywhere.
Like a Corman movie, it's Space, like, Wizards at War.
You know, you go, none of the science, if you try to make the science make sense, you are doomed.
Right.
In Star Wars. It really is like, you know, space wizard adventures, which is not to say I don't love Star Wars. I totally love Star Wars. But I don't think
there are women and people of colors and queers.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
Yeah. Yeah. All of that. Anyway, I don't think you necessarily have to have a science-free science fiction for it to be space opera.
Sure.
I think there's space opera where the...
Okay, I thought of one science-y space opera, I think.
So not science free. But this might be very, like, I don't know how many people will actually remember this, but Primary Inversion by, now I'm going to forget her name. Oh, I know. Okay, we're in a terrible place because I'm watching adorable Thor dad being dragged around by his little Hulk little child. Hulk. It's really adorable. Yeah. It's super adorable, and very distracting. But I'm not going to remember the name. But the title was, she got in so much trouble because she turned to romance. It was Catherine Asaro.
Okay.
The Primary Inversion, and she is a mathematician. She's like a PhD level mathematician.
Okay.
And her whole space opera thing turned on the idea of imaginary numbers, believe it or not. It was really kind of intense. But that was her real, like, hard science fiction. But I felt it could totally have fallen into space opera. And then later she did write like a sort of a gender harem weird thing, which was kind of more space opera, depending on how opera you want to go.
Sure,
right?
Sure. Naomi, you were on my Star Trek panel last night, and I really appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Would you consider Star Trek space opera?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's fun, exciting adventures in space.
Sure.
I mean, that definitely fits my vague, nebulous definition of space opera.
Okay.
Right, wasn't that when that include Guardians of the Galaxy?
Oh,
it would have to, wouldn't it? Yeah. And there's just no science to be found in that. It's all people living in a
Marvel science.
That works.
Right.
Yeah. The kind of we
Ego
were
the Living Planet is my son's favorite character in the comic books.
Okay, sure.
And when he found out Ego the Living Planet was going to be in this, he was like, I cannot believe all my dreams have come true. And then it's Kurt Russell. And he's like, who is this weird old guy?
What? Oh, no. You have to be introduced to Kurt Russell.
I was super hurt. And Squirrel Girl. Okay,
sorry. Oh, my God.
There's Squee over here.
Yeah,
we cannot focus. This
I thought
is the
it was,
worst ever.
It's Saturday afternoon. Who cares? I thought it was really funny that in the movie, he tells somebody in the movie about how when he was a kid and he didn't have a dad, he told his friends that David Hasselhoff was his dad.
That was great.
But then his dad turned out to be Kurt Russell. And it's like, you should tell kids that. That's an upgrade, if anything. What have you been doing at the con as far as panels?
I've been on a bunch of panels.
Yeah.
Naomi is the guest of honor.
Yeah, that's
I'm
true.
I'm one of the guests of honor, so they put me on lots and lots of panels. And I did a reading, and I did a signing, and
What was your favorite panel so far, Naomi?
Oh, wow, that's a hard question. Probably... Well, no, I did Enterprising Individuals podcast.
Oh, please,
was lots of fun.
No. Cut that out.
I thought the Foresight is 2020 panel went really well. It was only three people, but it was super fun. Like, I mean, we were, hopefully the audience was having fun. Like, I was having fun yakking, which, I mean,
was that a speculative fiction type thing? What
yeah,
was
it, was,
that?
It was a panel about how, like, science fiction predicts or fails to predict the future.
Okay.
Like the stuff that it gets right and the stuff that it gets wrong and the stuff that it predicted that we want, like hoverboards, everyone wants a flying skateboard.
Yeah, right.
Although then we discussed the fact that we would all die if we had flying skateboards to ride around on. None of us are coordinated enough to be trusted with a flying skateboard. So that panel was really fun. I am looking forward to a panel on fake science in the news later today, which should be fun.
Okay.
I'm moderating one on truth that's weirder than fiction, which I think it also
could
be super fun.
We actually did an episode of our show about that, specifically about futures in literature and movies that they've reached their sell-by date. So, for instance, the Days of Future Past in the X-Men comic books was set in, like, 1993 or something
right.
Yeah.
Skynet is already operational.
Exactly.
You know,
and
we actually had a party the day that Skynet went operational at my house because it was like, well, we might as well celebrate the end of the world, right?
Yeah. I can't wait to get my replicant in 2 years.
Exactly.
From Blade Runner.
Yeah, well, That was actually, okay, we did a panel. I had a panel yesterday on Near Future SF, which was had some significant overlap.
Sure.
And we talked about that a lot, like, you know, the issue of writing Near Future SF and then having the calendar catch up with your speculations.
Yeah.
And how much of a problem is this really? Because, I mean, you know, 1984 is not any less of a classic just because we're past 1984.
Sure.
I feel like they're definitely somewhere it reads as super, super dated now, and partly because of the dates. And then others where it's just like I feel like that it runs into you run into more problems when you have like, you know, a shiny future with flying cars and the Soviet Union than if you just stamped it as 1993 and now here we are, you know, decades later. Because you can easily if you can reboot it by just, you know, changing the dates, it right. doesn't feel nearly as dated. It's just funny.
Yeah.
Then if you've got like, you know, oh yeah, you know, in the future when we're doing like, you know, Mars colonization, the Cold War is still raging. Like,
I like it when creators.
If you write Cyberpunk and think DOS will still be around. That's something I did.
I know. Cyberpunk, but that's Cyberpunk's a great example. And also going off of that, like Blade Runner, I like it when creators double down. I don't know when it's set specifically or what their year is, but if you look at Blade Runner, the sequel coming up, they have doubled down. There's Atari ads, and I'm sure they're still at war with the Soviets, and they're just saying this is what's happening going forward.
Okay,
so.
See, that's really, you know, if you just go ahead and embrace it, that's really cool.
Yeah.
You can make that cool. You can sell that to me.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And just cyberpunk as a genre, like, we all thought that we were going to have chips in our heads and stuff like that.
I think it's coming eventually.
Great example. Yeah.
They wrote that, did that.
Right, right.
Totally guilty.
Which was... It was so exciting to think that we were so short-sighted to think that this would be, we'd have mirror shades in the 21st century.
See, this is my version of the hover skateboard.
Yeah,
I wanted this so bad in the 80s.
Yeah, yeah.
I really did. So yeah. There is that.
Well, I don't want to take you guys' time up too much, but thanks so much for joining me. If people want to find out more about your books and your work online, where can they go?
NaomiKritzer.com, NaomiKritzer, or Naomi... at Naomi Kritzer on Twitter.
Sure.
Yeah, and I'm actually at Tate Halloway on Twitter.
Right.
So that's my other one. And it's Halloway like hallway with all A's. And then you can find me at LydaMorehouse.com. You know,
awesome.
Nice and easy.
All right.
It actually takes you to both Tate's stuff and my stuff.
Great.
So,
thanks again for joining me.
Well, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Have a great con. Space opera is a hard thing to pin down.
It really is.
Except now you can just say Valerian and the City of a Thousand Planets.
There you go.
Oh, you mean that bad Clive Owen movie? That's the one. Yeah, I would say it's, you know, again, this is a show about polemics. Put that right in the title. It's on like the opposite side of cyberpunk, because cyberpunk is like everything's terrible and the government owns your memories. And space opera's like, hey, it's great.
Right.
You can defeat the evil overlord, get the princess with circuits braided into her hair or something like that. Because remember, in space, and then jet off to the next system and make a big furry friend or something like that. So it's hard to define, but I think we came close while talking to these two. If you want to check out either of their works online, you can go online. I think they mentioned this in the interview, but we'll double down on it. Go to Naomi Kritzer, that's KRITZER.com, to check out Naomi Kritzer's blog. She's also a political blogger.
Yep.
You can check out her things there. And you can find Lyda at LydaMorehouse.com. Both her work and her work as her pen name, Tate Holloway, are both available there. So thanks to those two for talking to us. Hope to talk to them again. Explain Aeon Flux to William Shakespeare. Assume he understands the little men and women in the box aren't real. It's not witchcraft. Radio and television waves in the air, electricity, that's all plastics. We got all that.
Are talking about the cartoon or
describe
the movie?
What happens in the concept of Aeon Flux to William Shakespeare?
Well,
Yon
will
strumpet.
Aeon Flux is a super, she's like an agent.
An agent of the crown.
And she basically fights bad guys and she kills them. And in the cartoon, she ends up dead, like in every episode.
How doth my yon strumpet return to the living?
I don't know.
Each go round.
I don't know how she returns to the living,
that
but
might
she
have been
does.
Pentameter. I got really good at faking Shakespeare after having done it for a decade.
I can understand that.
Because usually when you go up on stage, you know, you can just, if it's a mammoth play, well, I guess you have to have a lot of, you know, sentences that start, but no, well, they don't necessarily finish. I'm doing a bit right now. But in Shakespeare, like, you're screwed. What do you do?
Yeah.
There's nothing you can do.
That's right.
But I got really good at talking, or at least jamming words into a sort of, you know, iambic pentameter. And then a friend of mine came up with a great one. If you don't know where you are in the show, you know, when it's your turn, you just say, "In faith, I know not what to say," which
is
iambic
awesome.
Pentameter. And yeah, it's also the thing. So anyway, not what we're talking about. Yeah. Okay. That's good. I guess I was
hoping
that we would somehow broach, sadomasochism and cyberpunk and, intelligence and counterintelligence and just, I don't know how to explain this to somebody today.
It's hard.
Like, yeah. Like, what is it? You could say it's spy fiction.
Spy.
You could say that.
Thriller.
But
that's yeah.
so that falls so short of what it really is.
Yeah.
And you have to wonder how much of that is on Peter Chung.
Yeah, right.
What is he working out here?
I have no idea what
he's clearly drawing
out.
From influences. He is a Korean American animator and writer and creator who created it. I want to mention real fast, apropos of absolutely nothing, but one of my favorite artists who has never really found a big audience, but his stuff is amazing. Is named Eric Kennett. And he has a very, if you look at his drawings, you go, "That's so Aeon Fluxy." And it's, yeah, that was one of his first jobs.
Okay.
Was as an animator and like a storyboard guy for Peter Chung. So he kind of grew up under him.
Okay.
But anyway, not important. Yeah. Created by Peter Chung. And it is, it's about Aeon Flux, who we don't really know a lot about. She lives in a dystopian world that is in the future. We're never really given like a solid date.
No.
We are in the film, but we'll get to that. And where is this? You know, utopia literally means no place. It means, where is this? Is
right.
it? And so, and actually the first episode of the ongoing half-hour series is entitled Utopia or Deuteranopia, which is sort of a play on that idea. So, yeah, it takes place in a world. Here's what we know. We know that there are two nations, and it usually takes place in the space between them. It's like a future Berlin.
Sure.
There's the nation of Monica, and there's the nation of Bregna, or Brenya. And they're at war. Monica seems to be a open sort of anarchist society. Bregna is very much a republic, but like a... you know, goose-stepping kind of controlled republic, fascistic sort of place.
Sure.
Which sometimes is ruled by Trevor Goodchild. Sometimes
yes.
not. And sometimes, usually Aeon is working as a saboteur or an agent provocateur in the nation of Bregna to destabilize the government.
Yes.
But sometimes she's working for Trevor.
It gets confusing.
But confusion is the new watchword. Confusion is the norm. I think you are meant to be shocked and confused continually.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
I'm shocked and confused by her death that constantly happens.
So, yeah. So the deal is that it originally started, MTV came up with this experimental sort of animation block called Liquid Television.
Sure.
Where they would show... short, like very short things. You know, this was on for like, it's like the very first sort of Adult Swim kind of thing. They just show weird stuff. And a lot of this stuff, like I could read you a list of the things that were recurring segments, but you wouldn't know any of them.
Right.
I mean, you'd know Beavis and Butthead.
Yes.
You'd know that for sure.
Right.
You might know the Max or something like that, but the rest of them just didn't go anywhere. But they were trying stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember specifically seeing... I'm not going to say it's the first time that it was ever like on, but I remember seeing some of the first times that the Aeon Flux was aired in like 91 or 92. I actually remember being at a friend's house and we were doing something else and we had MTV on because that's what you did back then.
Right.
They played music videos.
They actually played them.
Yeah. Well, that's an old saw. And I remember in between videos, this thing would come on where this woman, you know, was running around in a thong and like, hyper, it was, you know, there was no Matrix back then. There's no, it was just super violent. You'd never seen a cartoon like this.
Sure.
And anime was kind of picking up. I may or may not have seen like a bootleg copy of a VCR, a VHS copy of Akira back then, but I was getting turned on to anime, and here was an American anime on MTV, no less.
Sure.
And so I was very drawn to this. And like back in the day, there's no streaming until it's released on VHS or eventually got its own half an hour block on MTV. You couldn't get any more.
Right.
So I remember just going to school the next day and being like, what was that? What did we see? What was that?
Right.
And talking about, oh, yeah, I was just shooting the guy. It's like, yeah, I'm just marinating on this, you know, just thinking about like what this could be and kind of coming up with your own theories and stuff. And I think the series lends itself to that because it's so, plot is so secondary to what happens in Aeon Flux. They are not worried right. about giving you a plot.
Right.
Or even character.
No.
Mood spelled backwards is often doom, but in this case it's good.
Right.
That doesn't work at all. What was your first exposure to Aeon Flux?
I had kind of heard about it through friends, but I hadn't actually really seen it until we watched it for the show.
Oh, okay.
So
just, but around though.
Yeah.
Did you know about the movie at all?
I knew about the movie. Hadn't seen it, but I knew about it.
Yeah. We'll get to that in a little bit. I just wanted to mention its history on MTV. So from like 91 until 95, it was on. It originally was released as the pilot itself is about 12 minutes long, and it's broken up into six 2-minute segments.
Okay.
And this is, we watched this. It sort of follows Aeon on some kind of mission.
Right.
We don't really understand what it is. The series is a triumph, in my opinion, of nonverbal storytelling.
Yes.
Vocal, but also verbal, because there is no text, really. There is no spoken dialogue until the half an hour series. And they still, they tell you what's going on. Like,
yeah.
The animation, I don't think is, it's probably good for the time, not great now, but it is expressive in a way that characters' facial expressions, their intent, them intending something and then thinking twice about it, all these things are communicated through their facial expressions, their body language, these complicated things that get pulled off really well. After that, it moved to its quote-unquote second season. It had 5-minute segments.
Okay.
Of course, like you mentioned, Aeon dies at the end of the pilot. And then we go to the 5-minute segments, of which there was five. And she basically dies at the end of each one of those
mm-hmm.
as well. Those, I think, are also perfect short films for the most part. Two that really stand out for me is the one called Tide, in which it's established right away. We never know anything about this world. Sometimes she's trying to kill Trevor. Sometimes she's making out with him and she's apparently right. working for him. In this particular case, they set up this rigid framework where she is got Trevor, you know, in handcuffs or something like that. And then she's with another girl who seems like she's working with her. And they've got this, you know, they've got this key. And
yeah.
in this building, an elevator with 6 floors. And so they go in the elevator and Trevor is a dick and he pushes all the elevator buttons because she's, we don't know what she's doing. She's trying to extradite or extract him, or maybe she's going to kill him. We don't know. And so we find out she has to use this key on a locker, and every yes. floor of this building has a locker. So she goes down one by one. She's going down the floors. And as she does, the story continues to develop and the tension gets racketed up because she has to run out to check this locker. And then we don't know what she's doing. But after she does, the entire episode, even the soundtrack slows down on this sort of like hovering sort of trilling note. And she, from far away, she has to shoot. There's a crane is lowering some kind of thing into like a hole or something.
Yep.
And she shoots it and it knocks it off balance so it can't. And she walks back to the elevator and the story continues to develop. We find out that the girl that is working with her is actually like in love or attracted to Trevor. So she's supposed to be looking for the key, which gets dropped behind this thing. Behind her, I think a dishwasher or like a clothes dryer or something like that.
Uh-huh.
Elevators in this universe are just rooms that move up and down.
Right.
They're gigantic for some reason. But so, yeah, so she's supposed to be looking for the key, but she just wants to make out with Trevor. And Aeon becomes aware surreptitiously that the girl is not helping her, so she sort of stages like a thing to kind of catch her not helping her. Meanwhile, every floor having to go out and check this locker and dodge bullets from this one other guy. So there are four or five different storylines individually that develop as they go down the levels.
Right.
And I'll spoil it because it's 30 years old. At the very end of it, she finally goes back in. She, you know, reveals that she knows that the girl is working with Trevor. The girl and Trevor overpower her. The girl gets the key and runs out to go put it in the locker. And she gets this thing that has a plug or something inside of it. It's like this big plug.
Yeah.
She doesn't know what it's for. She throws it away. Without Aeon to stop the soldier from coming down, he goes into the elevator. He's in the outfit of the people that usually work for Trevor, but he shoots Trevor for some reason. We don't know why.
Yeah.
Then he runs out, jumps on the plug. The crane thing finally connects to the plug, pulls it up. It pulls out a plug like the one the girl threw away.
Right.
The girl runs out and is stuck on one tiny little thing as the entire building sinks into the ocean. And it's like a Rube Goldberg. There's no context for anything. And just, it's one of those things that I continue to think about. Like when I'm just thinking about things that are great or when I'm trying to create things, I think like just the way that that's structured, I think is really great. Another good one is, and you can jump in anytime here if you have something to add.
No, I agree that that's a good one. That stood out in my mind from our rewatch recently.
Another great one is the one that comes right after that, War, which is not even focused on Aeon at all. And Peter Chung has said this when he developed it. The girl was never called Aeon Flux. He wanted to call the show Aeon Flux. And people just went, oh, okay, that sounds like a girl's name. Is that the girl with the hair curly cues?
Yeah.
And so that became her name by default.
Okay.
And he also never wanted to, he clearly wants to explore things like men and women in skimpy costumes. But he never wanted her to be the main character. And that's why he killed her off in the first pilot. But people liked the design so much that he's like, oh, okay, she's going to be the main thing. This is what MTV wants. I'll keep killing her.
Okay.
And see what happens.
Right.
So in this last episode called War, in the course of 5 minutes, we go through several lives all fighting this war. Aeon is in it in the beginning. She's captured, and it looks like she's going to get away. And in a twist, she's immediately killed.
Yeah.
And then the guy that kills her takes off his helmet, and he's this heroic-looking figure. He storms this base that they were defending. He gets in there and meets a guy with a sword, and he's like, sword, and tries to shoot the guy. The guy deflects the bullet, kills him.
Yep.
Now this guy with the sword we're following.
Yeah.
And he's got a young daughter that lives within the base. He's clearly protecting his family in this base. He runs out and gets on this ship that's attacking the base and kills all these people and then eventually is shot himself. And then we flip over to this other lady who is on the other team again. She gets into the base and like unlocks a cage or a cell that has another guy in there. They're clearly like
in love.
A couple. She's saving her boyfriend. And they start to run out, and the camera starts to focus in on this puddle of oil that has accumulated under the piston of the door to this base that's been opened.
Right.
And it's ominous, and it cuts before anything happens, but you know that
they're going to slip on it.
Or something.
Yeah.
You know, and the implication is that, I mean, it's hell. It's war. Like, it just goes on. There are all these, there are heroes on both sides to somehow redeem a stupid phrase that was in the opening crawl of Revenge of the Sith.
I really enjoy how weird this is. I mean, it's just very bizarre.
Yeah.
But it makes you think, because they're short little vignettes, but they...
It definitely doesn't overstay its welcome.
No.
That's one of the problems with the later half an hour series. This was released on DVD, or probably VHS, like in the late 90s.
Okay.
And I think they had all the shorts, and then I think they had the couple of the half an hour ones. And I remember getting it and thinking, that's great. Then they had like another one, like volume two, here's the rest of the stuff. And I was like, oh, great. And I got that. It was terrible.
Really?
And I was like, who took over this show? Like, how they're running it into the ground. Now that I've got Wikipedia, I can look at the list, the release list. And no, these ran at the same time the other ones did of the 10 or 12 half an hour ones. They collected all the good ones first. Good move.
Okay.
Yeah, get all the good stuff out there first. And then if people want one, you can sell them a kind of crappy second DVD. But anyway, I would recommend go seeing it. It was re-released the entire set together as a DVD in 2005, which may still be around. I actually don't know. But I know that you can find these... We're probably streaming somewhere. I don't know. If you've seen this, you own it, and you haven't, find somebody who owns it. It's really good. It's just, it's really unique. It's one of those examples of, yeah, sometimes, I want my MTV, like something like that can just throw money at something and,
yes,
like, and then just let somebody just start working on something. And I'm not talking about Teen Wolf. I'm talking about Aeon Flux. It's pretty great. And then it led to
Aeon Flux, the film.
Yeah. Which, let's get into it.
Yes, let's.
First of all, say three good things about Charlize Theron.
She's pretty. She's,
whoops. Strong, first thing, huh? First thing.
Yeah, well, she's a strong actress. She does a lot of her own stunt work, which is to be commended.
Yeah, she like broke her neck on this film.
I know.
Yeah. And stopped filming for like 6 weeks.
Yeah.
It was like the first week of filming.
So.
Not great.
No. So I commend her for that, but but at the same time, it kind of sucks.
Yeah.
Let's see, what else? She plays strong female characters a lot of the time.
Yeah. You're just describing her.
Yeah.
You're not really saying something that she like accomplished. I guess I just said three good things.
Yeah.
You didn't ask me to do it, so I'm not going to do it.
Okay.
Maybe you can hit me later with that. This movie came out in 2005.
Yeah.
Here's Wikipedia's sort of summary. It is a science fiction spy action film. Well, gosh.
Yeah.
We should have just said that for the cartoon. What was wrong with us? Of course. Of course that's what it is. Or maybe this is just really, really boiled down from the source material.
It is.
Could there have ever been, now or in the future, which you can't see, like a real faithful adaptation of Aeon Flux?
Oh, that's hard to say because it's so bizarre. And
it's almost kind of the Matrix, though, isn't it?
Kind of.
I bet if you asked the Wachowskis, they would probably tell you, yeah, we watched Aeon Flux. Of course we did.
Sure.
They're wearing a little more clothes, but yeah, they're still fighting against a system. There is mind effery and guns.
Right.
Lots of guns.
Yes.
Get out of here, Dean DeHaan. Oh, I'm sorry. You're Keanu Reeves. What happens in this film?
Basically, Aeon is hired to commit. She's hired to kill. What's his name?
Trevor.
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 Yeah. And he's like the
great bad guy,
the dictator leader guy.
Yeah.
And she gets up to him, right next to him on stage, and like she can't do it.
Yes, they're on a stage.
Yeah.
Which is probably a metaphor for something.
Probably.
You want to double team this one?
Sure.
Because you forgot the fact that it takes place in the year 2415.
Okay, well, yeah.
It's much more grounded in something that you can recognize as Earth.
Yes. It's Earth, all right.
And they it's Earth, all right. And they take, it's set in Bregna,
uh-huh,
this militaristic sort of city-state. But there's more of a reason. They live in this giant city, which is apparently the last city on Earth. There was some sort of plague that, you know, wipes out 99% of the population. And so they've all been herded into one city for protection. And then at the same time, Earth has been decimated. Supposedly it is a total wasteland. Like, you wouldn't want to go outside the walls.
Right.
Like Blake 7. And so, yeah, now we've got, instead of like, one thing that is funny, actually, I think a benefit of the cartoon is to watch Trevor's kind of weird justifications for why he takes so much power and why you have to, you know, show your papers at every checkpoint and stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
And it's a lot of it is can't talk about something good. We have to talk about this film, but a lot of it is a meditation on the idea of control and power and how somebody's got to be in charge of a society. That's society.
Right.
If Aeon got her way, we'd all be wearing bits in our mouths in the wasteland. Like, you wouldn't have any organization. But we'd have fun, though. So, yeah, I think that that's a lot more justified in this. There is a council of smart guys. It is a ruled by scientists, a technocracy. where Johnny Lee Miller, of all people,
yeah,
and his brother, played by Martin Saukas, who was Celeborn in Lord of the Rings. I'm trying to think of other stuff he's been in.
Yeah.
They're brothers, and they rule along with these other scientists, and, you know, they're tough but fair. They do this because we have to.
That's right.
But there are people that disagree. We never really get a suggestion because there's only one city-state. There's no real Monica in this, so the revolutionaries are just simply called Monikans, and they stick a chewing gum in their back or something like that, or a marble in their back that allows them to telepathically communicate with the other resistance members who are led by Frances McDormand in her best Brave cosplay.
Yeah.
What is going on?
That's about it.
This must have been Frances McDormand was just coming down off of the Fargo high.
Yeah.
Because she'll never go away, and thank God. But, you know, she was real hot after Fargo, did a lot of stuff, kind of maybe cooled off for a while.
Yeah.
And didn't come back. Maybe we had to do something like this. I mean, Burn After Reading wasn't until 2008. So anyway, so she's their leader. And you get the idea that, and this film never gets this, like, cerebral, but she's controlling them as well.
Right.
You know, the freedom fighters are also under their own sort of control.
Right.
Especially because they are so sort of committed to this cause. They're zealots, and they don't question their orders. So they probably do things like, you know, blow up bombs in public places and things like that. They're terrorists, basically. Right. Yeah. And Aeon wears a beaded curtain to sleep in.
Yes.
Because it's hot or something. I don't know. Yeah. Long story short, we ruin things, don't we?
Yeah, we ruin things.
We want to ruin it?
Well, let's...
We'll see if we get there.
Okay.
She has a character named Una, who's a character who's adapted from one of the half-an-hour shows. But in this, she is Aeon's sister.
Yes.
And Aeon's sister Una is killed by the Breen... sometimes they're called Breen. Like, I guess Bregnan, that sounds dumb.
I guess so.
So by the Breen secret police, because they think that she is a Monikan.
Yeah.
And of course, Aeon has guilt over this because she thinks that they were coming for her and got her sister instead.
Right.
So now she's going to kill Trevor Goodjohn. Get him. She's going to get him.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And hijinks ensue from there.
Yeah.
But we learn that all is not what we think.
That's right.
There's a whole twist and flip over and what in this film, which is that everybody is clones.
Yeah.
None of this makes any sense. I'll just say it all and we can pretend like it never happened. Like this movie for the most part. Everybody has been cloned long, long ago, back when they had Jettas, for instance, our time. Trevor Goodchild was a scientist who was married to, do you remember her real name? I don't know. It doesn't matter.
Catherine or something like that.
Yeah, something. Married to Aeon Flux's character.
Yeah.
And that's when this virus hit in the modern day. And they came up with a cure, but the problem with the cure was it made everybody sterile.
Yeah.
And so they developed cloning techniques, and they have been cloning everybody. And so when somebody dies, they just make another one as a baby, I assume.
Yes.
And then just give the babies to people.
Yes.
Telling people that they aren't sterile? Or they know they're sterile? I really don't care at this point.
I've lost the plot. It was something like they knew that they're sterile, but like they inseminated there was like some scientific stuff going on.
Right. They go like, oh, I'm going to go to the doctor for my, pelvic exam or whatever. And then they
give them the juice. They would implant the baby. So then the pregnancies would be pretty much what you'd expect.
And you never question that, like, wow, it looks like a lot like your mom because it's your mom, basically.
Right.
Which is, it's weird.
That's weird.
That's weird.
That's weird.
But you know what's really weird? Pete Postlethwaite taking care of all this stuff in a blimp. There's this blimp. Some of the design in this, a lot of the design in this film is influenced by the production itself. Karen Kusama directed it. I think one of her first movies was Girl Fight. She's known mostly for that. She actually wanted Michelle Rodriguez to play Aeon Flux, but that didn't work out. She wanted to film in Brazil because she thought that's the architecture of Brazil would fit Bregna. Didn't work out. ended up filming in Berlin instead. And this movie looks like it was filmed in Germany.
Yeah.
So I think a lot of the design came from where it was filmed. But also, a lot of it is just, it's kind of what are they thinking, but also like, it's like Valerian. It's like, okay, that's really weird. I don't know why you would keep all of the DNA samples in a huge jellyfish-looking blimp that just flies around over the city over and over again, except to keep it out of people's hands.
Right.
And then when you get up there, you've got Pete Postlethwaite is up there wearing some insulation tubing over his head. And he reveals to Aeon that out of all these years, she had never been brought back.
Yeah.
Because the Trevor we see is merely the iteration, you know, spawned clone of Trevor after Trevor.
Right.
They never talk about how they re-educate them. Do they just tell them, all right, you were Trevor before. Here's your
something
research.
Like that.
Now you're going to build on it. I guess that works. Anyway.
Yeah.
But this is the first time around that Aeon has ever been around since the time that she died 400 years ago. Because Johnny Lee Miller felt that she was a bad influence on his brother. And he needs his brother to fix this, to find the cure.
Right.
And guess what? He was right. He was totally right.
Yeah.
Because she completely destabilizes this civilization.
She does.
And changes everything. For the sexier. we got so many things we can talk about, but let's try to bring it home real fast. Not very sexy.
No.
I think I commented.
Gross.
Well, see, but gross is part of the cartoon, though.
Yeah.
Things are supposed to be gross. I think I commented just apropos of nothing that I was trying to put it up like, Charlize Theron, hottest ever in Aeon Flux or in Reindeer Games? And I think you came down on Flux.
Yeah.
I don't know. It could go either way for me. Not really important. Not what we need to be talking about. But they tried to put her in skimpy outfits, but it never felt, you never felt the sensuality of the series in this.
That's true.
Because it's shot in Berlin. It has this super cold aesthetic. And whereas absolutely like Aeon in the cartoon as well is, you know, an implacable sort of secret agent. She's fairly professional, but she loves a party.
Yeah.
You know, she definitely has a feminine side, a human side. And that's completely burned out of Theron's character.
Yeah.
Doesn't exist.
No.
She's sad when her sister dies. That's about it.
That is about it.
Yeah. And it's too bad because I think, you know, what's she fighting for? Maybe that was their point. Maybe that's what they were going for. But
They make her kind of stoic and removed.
Could be hotter.
I
don't really know what I'm saying. I'm just saying series that's clearly based on sexuality and issues like that. Like nobody really gets an honest thing at all.
That's true. Well, her and Goodchild do have sex at one point.
Kind of.
It's implied.
Yeah, I guess.
But it's not like really like a super sexy time.
No, that's what I'm saying.
You know.
I mean, I'm not worried about the amount of sex that happens. It doesn't ever feel sexy. You know what I mean?
Do I make you feel horny, baby?
Sure.
Do I?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Or that. Whatever that is.
It
was written by Phil Hay and Matt Manfredi. It's interesting to note that Phil Hay is Karen Kusama's husband.
Okay.
And has pretty much written all of her films at this point.
Okay.
Here's what he's worked on. Stop me if you like any of these. Crazy Beautiful.
Okay.
The Tuxedo. Clash of the Titans reboot.
Okay.
R.I.P.D. Ride Along.
Wow.
Get a divorce. Get a divorce. That's the only way that you're going to move forward. Her films, and she's been hailed as, you know, kind of an up-and-coming director, especially after her girl fight. Here's what she's done so far. Aeon Flux. Jennifer's Body.
Oh, boy.
A film called The Invitation. And she submitted or contributed one quarter of the female-led anthology horror film XX.
Okay.
So, movie guru Tara, frequent guest on the show, warned us off The Invitation.
Yeah.
She specifically said, don't watch The Invitation. And this is before we knew we were going to do a Karen Kusama movie for the show.
Yes.
So, I braved Netflix last night.
Oh boy.
To watch The Invitation.
And?
I want you to guess how many minutes in I got.
10.
That's how many minutes in I got.
Hey.
Nice. Oh. Awful.
Really?
Terrible.
Okay.
And it's a dialogue. It's the kind of way, it's that whole thing like, no one talks this way.
Yeah.
Now, John, I know you've been a brain surgeon for 20 years now, and your brother and I had a falling out, but that doesn't mean that we can't. Nobody talks like that.
Like exposition fill in?
That, and also it's like a bunch of maybe late 20-somethings getting together for somebody's wedding or something like that. And they're like, haha, this guy back at the old frat house, he certainly was a blah, blah. Nobody talks like that.
No.
Whatever. Oh, man, you're such a Cro-Mag. I assume short for Cro-Magnon? No one's ever said Cro-Mag sounds delicious. It sounds like I'd pick it up at Glam Doll Donuts. But nobody talks like that.
No.
Get a divorce. I would love to see what you can do when your husband's not writing the stuff.
Yeah.
And man, Matt Manfredi, his Cro-Mag buddy from from the frat house. And I also tried to watch her segment of XX.
Yeah.
Minute count?
Five.
Exactly. You're good at this.
Hey.
You're really good at this. Yeah. My Only Living Son, I think her segment's called. I don't even know what it's about. I didn't finish it, but it is set up as a, I'm not sure what the horror element is, but it's kind of a, we need to talk about Kevin-y sort of thing. Single mom, raising a kid who's like torturing pets and stuff like that. And she's like,
great.
I don't know if I should say or do anything. You should. You should say or do something.
Yes.
You really ought to.
Yeah.
And at one point, he's mad because he's going to turn 18 and he can't see his dad. She's like, well, I'm sorry. Your father is too interested in being a Hollywood star than being a father. Are you effing kidding me?
Wow.
Click. Let's watch Dope. Great movie. Watch Dope. Check it out. If we ever talked about good movies on the show, I would want to talk about Dope. Let's talk about just specific moments that we enjoyed.
I enjoyed when the trees were shooting at them.
I was going to mention that. That's actually based on a scene from one of the cartoons that I didn't want to bring up because we talked about the cartoons too much, but let's do it now. What's it called? I can't remember what it's called, but it's an episode where Trevor invents cloning. And the thing about the half an hour episodes is that she doesn't die in them. It's never, they're never committed to continuity either, but it's not a gag where she dies every time. But she does kind of in this one. And I'll ruin it, because like I said, 30 years old. She goes in and her job is to assassinate Trevor or whatever. And she's going to go with this other character named Scafandra in the cartoon, but changed to Sithandra in this for some reason.
Yeah.
I'm not really sure why. And she's played.
It sounds like mythology almost. You know what I mean?
Yeah, kind of, I guess. Maybe they just liked Sith, like Star Wars was big at the time. Played by Sophie Okonedo, who was Liz 10 on Doctor Who.
Okay.
And done plenty of other stuff. And she's the girl with the feet for hands.
Yes.
Or hands for feet. Feet for hands would be rough. That'd be a rough one.
Yeah.
That's Kick Puncher.
Yeah.
And so they do this. There's this segment in the thing. The whole thing is they have to break into Trevor's mansion, and the only way to do it is with two people.
Okay.
Two operatives can twist the branch so the pine cone that shoots needles goes the other way. That's what's in the movie. Or can pull somebody out of the razor grass. There's cooler stuff in the show. But anyway, so they both make it in, but it's clear that she's either a double or triple or something else agent. You know, Aeon can't trust her.
Okay.
And Aeon knows that Trevor's invented this cloning thing, so she's decided to get the best of both worlds. So she's going to teach Trevor a lesson and also get to screw his brains out because she loves and hates him at the same time.
Okay.
So she allows Trevor to take some of her hair, and she kind of knows that he's done this.
Okay.
Trevor goes and makes a clone of Aeon so he can, you know, not have his way with her. He's actually got, we find out later, like a room full of Aeons.
Okay,
that's
great.
Kind of weird. But he wants to, you know, get an Aeon that is separated from this whole conflict between them. So Aeon goes and waits, and he makes the clone, and she's like, oh, well, this should be interesting. Okay, good night, Trevor. And then the clone gets up, and of course, a clone of Aeon is still Aeon, and meets Aeon, and they're like, all right, are you ready for the plan? They switch places.
Okay.
So the real Aeon goes and lives with Trevor, and they live like this life of romantic bliss, while the clone goes and continues to carry out whatever the mission is. Well, one thing leads to another. Scafandra succumbs to her own treachery and is killed. And now Aeon has to get out, and the other clone Aeon shows up, because two people need to do this run, right?
Right.
But clone Aeon, or excuse me, real Aeon has now fallen in love with Trevor completely and doesn't want to leave.
And
the clone convinces her to do the run. So they're doing this run, and just as they get to the end, clone Aeon has made it out, and real Aeon lets herself get shot, you know, Jean Grey on the moon style, and commits suicide by turret because she can't, you know, take the fact that
she can't be with Trevor.
Given her heart to Trevor, yeah.
Yeah.
And then clone Aeon runs off, and she's the protagonist from there on out.
Okay.
Is that cool? Or is that cool?
That's cool.
Nothing like that happens in this film.
No.
Not at all. It's just an example of them going, okay, yeah, looking at a picture and going, yeah, can we make that happen? Let's make sure she captures a fly with her eye lashes, because there's no way that that's just a one image kind of metaphor of, you know, a dangerous femininity, you know, in a weird world.
Right.
That's definitely something that she does every day when she wakes up in the morning.
Right.
Dumb. I think it never caught on. Oh, Patterson Joseph is in this, and it's always fun to see him. He doesn't get to do anything. I think it's weird because you have to give it to Kasama and her team for just going for it.
Yeah.
It took something that was very tough to adapt, and they adapted it, and they didn't really. They could have made this way more like a Schwarzenegger film, you know, or they could have made it more commercial. Is what I'm saying.
Yeah,
and it turns out to be a movie that serves no one. Because it disappoints the fans, it totally alienates your average audience. And I saw they're interviewing Charlize Theron all day, every day, these days, because of Atomic Blonde. And I saw her talking about this movie, and she's like, yeah, it's a piece of shit. Like, nobody knew what they were doing. And I think she was kind of being unkind. I think that they, you know, you tried.
They tried.
Here's your participation ribbon.
Yeah.
Whereas Atomic Blonde, from what I've seen in the trailers, is a movie that is serving everyone.
Yeah.
Like, it's got action, it's got sex, it's a period piece, it's got a lot of 80s music, and it's like, okay, guys, you're about as sweaty as Olivia Newton-John getting physical. Reference. I'm trying to think, come on, one good thing.
There are a lot of backflips and stuff like that in this.
There are a lot of backflips.
The room that keeps changing when she like goes in undercover.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that was weird.
Yeah.
Oh shoot, we're way past Valerian, and that reminds me kind of something that we didn't talk about in Valerian, which was Big Market.
Oh yeah.
I want to do a whole show on Big Market. Big Market was awesome. And all I want to do is just log that I really enjoyed Big Market and would have watched an entire movie about Big Market. But
sure.
Anyway, go see Valerian for Big Market.
There you go.
But yeah, it's kind of a switchy, mind screwy, you've got to keep track of like two different geographies type thing that was really neat.
Yeah. And she has like this little thing that sticks on her, which is like,
Who knows
yeah. what.
Yeah, that was neat.
But it was like kind of like octopus leg like and everything.
Yeah. I was just looking at some of my notes for the film. This will serve as my sort of epitaph for the film.
Okay.
I did say the thing about serves no one. And then they start to get really weird. Like, I'm not sure what I'm even talking about after a while.
That's not good.
I have a note that says, it was at this point that I gave up. I don't know what that reference is, but it could have referenced a couple different things. Apparently, they were in a room that looked like the Cloud City Darth Vader turkey dinner room.
Oh.
I wrote that down. That's going to be a long episode title. And then maybe she got in a fight with somebody in a science lab, but I put Bunsen burned, bitch.
Yes, she did.
Okay.
Yeah.
So anyway, would you recommend Aeon Flux? 2005.
I would not recommend it.
It's only 92 minutes long.
It's not a short.
It's
bad. It's not
and
a long
small
movie.
Portions.
Yeah, it's not a long movie, but it's not necessarily a good movie either.
No. It's,
so
no, I would
I think
have
you
to
can skip it.
I'd have to steer people away as well. I feel bad for Kusama, who, face it, does some good things in this, and I, like I said, get a divorce. I wish that she could get hooked up with somebody that could give her a script that really does something and goes somewhere.
Yeah.
But for all the kind of interesting thing, I don't know, maybe there's like a highlight reel on YouTube, but I really can't recommend going through the whole thing.
No, I can't either.
There are much better Charlize Theron movies.
Yeah, go see Fury Road for one.
Well, yeah, no kidding. There's better Johnny Lee Miller movies out there. And he also doesn't really do a ton in this.
He doesn't do a lot in this at all.
It's too bad.
Yeah. Underutilized Johnny Lee Miller.
Strike one, MTV Films. Strike one. They've retired entire series at this point. But
yeah.
Yeah. Aeon Flux. Don't go see it. Yeah, not great. I wish that Aeon would sneak in and plant a bomb on this, and then we'd be done with it.
That'd be great.
So we've got a little kind of blip in our calendar here, because there are so many releases, which we've talked about, which we'll be covering as the year goes on. But 2 weeks from now, when we do our next Craft Disservices segment, we don't have anything lined up. There's nothing that we have to serve. There's, you know, we have no masters. This one's on us.
Sure.
And we should do something fun.
We should.
You know, something bad, but fun.
Yeah.
After all of this multiplicity, and I apologize for that one. Not great. So we got to do something fun that really is in the spirit of Craft Disservices, a movie that is not great and critics hated, but audiences loved. And that's going to be Beastmaster.
Awesome.
Beastmaster.
I'm looking forward to it.
42%. That's too low.
It's pretty low.
Well, maybe it's just right. We did get a chance to see Beastmaster at like a midnight matinee recently. And so it's fresh in our minds. We're ready to talk about it. And we should save it for then.
Yeah.
So check that out in 2 weeks. Beastmaster on Craft Disservices.
We got the Refugees All-Stars rubber-dubbing in the club. Wyclef Jean. John Forte. Now I'm in the streets again, a little crazy.
So one more reminder, we are talking about Valerian and Laureline, the comic book, next week on our Comic Book Club segment. Now, you've read a little bit of it already, haven't you?
Yes, I have.
What is your first impression? Can you give us a little sneak peek?
It's all right. It's,
whoa, that's not good.
I mean, again, they don't really give Lorelai a lot to do.
Yeah.
And
a comic from the 60s?
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, I'm not, that wouldn't blow me away.
Yeah.
I guess. But, geez, that's what you update.
I
know. When you adapt something, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, we'll be talking about the first collection of the Valerian and Laureline series called The City of Shifting Waters. Say that five times fast.
Oh, my goodness.
I think I've expended our quota of S words for this, so I will not try to. That's available online. I've actually never seen, these are probably pretty old at this point, and I'm not sure about the reprint status of them. So you're going to want to check this out online if you want to read along with us. It is The City of Shifting Waters, and that'll be next time on our Comic Book Club for next show. And that's it. Gosh darn it. I think we did it. This is like 20, this is a 1,000 planets worth of sausage in a one planet bag. That doesn't make any sense.
No, it doesn't.
But I think we managed to accomplish it somehow. So thanks to our great guests for talking with us. And thanks to you. If you want to talk with us or continue the discussion, you can do that online on Facebook and Twitter at our social media outlets. Search for Just Enough Trope on those platforms and like us or follow us there, because we'd love to hear from you. Also, you can find the show on iTunes. If you go to iTunes and search for Just Enough Trope, there we are. It's our iTunes show page. And when you're there, subscribe.
Yes.
Subscribe to the show. It's so important because you get it right away. And then also iTunes knows you're out there. You can give us a review as well. We'd appreciate that because we love hearing from the fans and hearing how you think we're doing. And probably the most important thing of all, give us a rating. Why?
Ratings are important. It helps us move up in the ranks.
Does that have to do with how the algorithm on iTunes works?
It does. People know that we're doing well. iTunes knows that we're doing well.
Yeah.
And then we can bring more news to you.
Yeah. That's right. You move up in those ranks.
That's right.
Those ranks. It's a mean streets out there.
That's right.
Those ranks are mean. We got to try to move up in there. Number one with a bullet. That's how you do it. So if you're there on iTunes, give us 5 planets. I mean, it's got to be planets, right?
Sure.
And that'll be 5 more towards our total of 1,000 planets. People, we're asking you to help us reach 1,000 planets. Once we have that, then we'll have something for my father. Oh, man.
Oh.
Oh, man.
Man.
Give us 5 stars, by the way. For my father. I hope. So is his father alive?
I have no
dedicated
idea.
To his father. For my father. I kind of hope he's dead. Then you don't have to see the movie.
Stop it.
Yeah, not great. I can just see it now. Beep, beep. Heart monitor in the background says, "My son, when does the film come out?" "It comes out tomorrow, Papa." And he says, "C'est bon."
Oh.
Right? He missed it. He didn't have to watch it. Terrible. Terrible. But maybe a slice of what he's made me feel. He's been off for a while now. Because yeah. Lucy was his last big thing.
Yeah.
And even Lucy, which is not a good film, still had sort of embraced that kind of weird, like, what the, anything could happen in this film?
Yeah.
I mean, sure, every time Martin Freeman comes on to say, "Human only use 10% of the brain." It's like, what, I hate hearing that thing repeated over and over again. But okay, apparently you can turn into a goo computer and do kung fu, like, if you take this drug. Fine. Take me somewhere, movie. Fine. This movie had all these aliens and worlds, at least 37 planets to work with, and still just feels like, okay, I don't like this bit. Fast forward. Oh, I like this bit. This bit's better.
Right.
So it's a little disappointing.
It is.
We need to get together and get the fund going to get the Luc Besson fastball back.
Okay.
Or whatever. Oh, lacrosse. It's like, what's baseball in France? Lacrosse. Maybe not. I don't know. So anyway, yeah, go check us out on iTunes if you would. I think that's pretty much it for now. I want to remind you, we are reading Valerian and Laureline, The City of Shifting Waters, for our next show. So check us out next week for that. We're going to sign off for now. I'm your host, Caliban.
I'm your co-host, Mikan Hanna.
Keep the geek fires burning.
9-7 till infinity high. Refugee all stars. Can't stop the shining. Can't stop the shining. Can't stop the shining. Can't stop the shining. You wanna stop the shining?